committee. And so I want to commend you for promptly being here the day after the president's budget. I think you're the first cabinet secretary that is testifying on behalf of the president's budget, and I want to thank you for that. After 2 years of economic failures, the American people desperately want results. The budget before us today calls for $4.7 trillion in new taxes and $6.9 trillion in new spending during a staggering debt crisis. The American people are struggling. We know because they told us in Yukon, Oklahoma, and in Petersburg, West Virginia, during hearings with this committee. Whether it's Kelly Payne, a fifth-generation rancher from Oklahoma, or Ashley Bachman, a mother of three and small business owner in West Virginia, the president's inflation crisis is threatening their livelihoods. The president's budget means more pain, with $1.8 trillion in new taxes on Main Street businesses, many of which still have help wanted signs hanging in their windows because of the Democrat-fueled worker shortage. The $650 billion small business surtax will hit mom-and-pop small businesses, violating President Biden's pledge not to increase taxes on small businesses. The $77 billion increase in the death tax will force family farms and ranches to sell their assets or risk closing their doors. The $37 billion in new taxes on American-made energy will kill jobs, raise prices, and make us more dependent on foreign countries for our energy needs. And President Biden's global tax surrender to foreign governments will make it better to be a foreign worker or business than an American one. It's a tax deal only China would love. Working Americans are scratching their heads over how you'll enforce these taxes too. But I think your budget answers that question too. Democrats handed the IRS an $80 billion raise last year. Taxpayers are now asked in this budget to hand the IRS another $43.2 billion. I have to ask, is that a joke? After a two-year inflation crisis that has cost American workers more than 2 months of pay, families need every penny they can get. But they can't even get their own refunds back because of the historic backlog at the IRS. And they can't get through to a human at the agency because of the terrible customer service. The IRS needs to address its trust gap. When ProPublica announced it had obtained a vast trove of confidential and private taxpayer information, the American people was rightly worried. What was stolen? Is their information safe? To this day, Treasury has provided no public answers. What they do have is Treasury's commitment to inject woke, racial, and climate politics in our monetary policy and our tax code. The Treasury Department is woefully falling short in fulfilling its core mission. I hope that our discussion today covers these topics and more in a productive way than we are finally able to get answers to the questions the American people have been demanding. I'm pleased to recognize Ranking Member from Massachusetts, Mr. Neal, for his opening statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We want to welcome the Secretary this morning to the Ways and Means Committee. As is always the case, it's an honor to have the Treasury Secretary here. You should know that when Secretary Mnuchin took my phone calls, he promptly appeared before the Ways and Means Committee as well, and I met with him regularly to discuss policy. There is much that can be accomplished when the cameras are not turned on. Secretary Yellen is one of the brightest, most accomplished policymakers I've known during all my years in government. She is the first person in American history to have led the White House Council of Economic Advisors, the Federal Reserve, and the Treasury Department. I have sought her advice many times, and her leadership has contributed to the historic round of lawmaking and the rebound of the American economy. She is a mainstream economic thinker. And I also would point something out. The debacle of 2008 with deregulation of markets, what happened? Again, what happened with the pandemic? She was the one that we sought for counsel on how to step forward. But we didn't do it with just Secretary Yellen. Hank Paulson was on the call with us as well. We sought a bipartisan response. And based upon the evidence of recovery, it worked. President Biden's economic plan is working, and the economy is growing at a solid clip. Nearly 13 million new jobs, including a 500,000 in January, and 311,000 this morning. And the labor force participation rate ticked up. Labor force participation declined. It has been stubborn, largely because of the pandemic and the retirement of the baby boomers. That has been transformational in our economy. But rebuilding the economy from the bottom up and the middle out has been the president's push, and we agree with him on this side. The budget that he released yesterday was important, and now we have a blueprint, and we look forward to hearing what the other side has to say when, at some point, they might lay out their budget plan. Many of us heard us say before that a strong recovery was never guaranteed, but never bet against the American worker or underestimate the dignity and security of a paycheck. And how did we get here? We invested directly in people and their families. We expanded the child credit. We cut the child poverty rate in half. And no policy has done more to reduce childhood poverty than the child tax credit. We also take credit. I want to thank the members of the committee here. After a long 3.5 days of markup, that yesterday the president's budget took the Ways and Means tax package almost to the item. We sustained millions of low and middle income families with the Earned Income Tax Credit and the Child and Dependent Care Credit, which was essential. The American Rescue Plan permanently increased the federal child care investment. It enabled workers to reenter the workforce, and it helped to give parents peace of mind. Our work to encourage clean energy is also spurring growth for small businesses and for workers and their families across the country. And I want to say that publicly and privately in Oklahoma, that position that we adopted with the Inflation Reduction Act in conversations I had there was pretty well received. When coupled with the bipartisan infrastructure law and the tax credits championed by Ways and Means Democrats in the IRA, the clean energy economy is accelerating and millions of green jobs are now on the horizon. I look forward to working with the administration to implement the IRA as text in Congress intended. This was a monumental achievement. While free trade agreements are a purview of Congress, I stand ready to partner with durable and enforceable policies that fulfill the objectives of the IRA. Our multi-year investment in the Internal Revenue Service is making great headway already in ushering in new service for American taxpayers. The IRS was severely underfunded, and now, with the infusion of Democratic support, 99.7% of the returns are being processed, and more Americans are getting their service that they deserve. We are pleased that Commissioner Werfel is in place. Contrast that between our achievements and extremism, it is clear. Yesterday, we marked up legislation signaling the intent of our government to default. You know better than anyone, prioritizing debt is not an option. We are here today, Madam Secretary, to welcome you and thank you for your great gift to America, your sheer competence.
Today's sole witness is United States Treasury Secretary Janet Yellen. The committee has received your written statement, and it will be made part of the formal hearing record. You have 5 minutes to deliver your oral remarks. Secretary Yellen, you may begin when you're ready.
Chairman Smith, Ranking Member Neal, and members of the committee, thank you for inviting me to discuss the administration's fiscal year 2024 budget. The president's proposals prioritize growth-enhancing investments that will build on the economic progress we've made, along with significant tax reforms that will substantially reduce the deficit, improve our long-run fiscal outlook, and reduce fiscal risks. Over the past 2 years, the United States has experienced an historic economic recovery. In January 2021, our country was in the middle of an economic calamity triggered by the coronavirus pandemic. But Congress and the President took decisive action through the American Rescue Plan and our vaccination campaign. This January, 2 years after the President took office, we reached the lowest unemployment rate in over 50 years. We've seen the strongest 2 years of business creation in history, and real U.S. GDP per capita is at an all-time high. Now our task is to navigate our economy's transition from rapid recovery to sustainable growth. Our administration's top economic priority remains bringing down inflation. We've seen some moderation in headline inflation, but more work needs to be done. Our administration will continue to build on the actions we've taken to expand supply and provide cost relief in areas like energy and healthcare. These actions have made a meaningful difference for American families. With your partnership, we've also laid a foundation for long-term economic growth through an approach that I call modern supply-side economics. This approach seeks to boost the economy's productive capacity by expanding the workforce and increasing productivity. In just the past 2 years alone, Congress passed three transformational laws, a generational investment in infrastructure, an historic expansion of American semiconductor manufacturing, and the largest investment in clean energy in our nation's history. A strategic priority for our administration this year is to work with you to effectively implement these laws. And we're seeing the early results. In just 7 months, we've seen a wave of tens of billions of dollars of investment in clean energy manufacturing across the country. And our new investment in the IRS is already paying off. Taxpayers are getting drastically improved customer service this year. For example, we've answered hundreds of thousands more phone calls during this filing season than at this time last year. Our proposed budget builds on our economic progress by making smart, fiscally responsible investments. And these investments would be more than fully paid for by requiring corporations and the wealthiest to pay their fair share. Fiscal discipline remains a central priority in our budget. We have proposed a minimum income tax of 25% on taxpayers with wealth in excess of $100 million. We have also proposed an increase in the corporate tax rate to 28% from the current 21%. And it will come as no surprise that I hope Congress will implement the United States part of the global minimum tax deal. This new regime will end a race to the bottom in corporate taxation and raise crucial revenue for essential investments like those proposed in the president's budget. On the spending side, we suggest additional investments to boost our long-term growth potential. This includes improving the availability of high-quality childcare, providing free and universal preschool, and boosting the supply of affordable housing. We also propose restoring the child tax credit and earned income tax credit expansions that were enacted in 2021 but have since expired. Importantly, with the proposed tax reforms, we estimate that this budget will deliver deficit reduction of nearly $3 trillion over the next 10 years. I've spoken about the promise of the president's budget, but I'd be remiss if I did not mention a wholly separate issue that could threaten the economic progress that we have made. As you know, I've asked Congress to raise or suspend the debt limit. Since 1789, the United States has always paid its bills on time, and it must continue to do so. In my assessment, and those of economists across the board, a default on our debt would trigger an economic and financial catastrophe. I urge all members of Congress to come together to address the debt limit without conditions and without waiting until the last minute. Thank you, and I look forward to taking your questions.
Thank you, Madam Secretary, for your testimony. Without objection, each member will be recognized for 3.5 minutes to accommodate the Treasury Secretary's time. As always, we have to ensure that all members have an opportunity to ask questions of the Secretary. We'll now proceed to questions and answers session, and I'll begin with it first. Yesterday, Secretary, I sent you a letter asking that you provide this committee with legislative language that would accomplish the $4.7 trillion in tax increases contained in your budget proposal within 30 days. The American people, they deserve to know exactly how the Biden administration plans to raise their taxes and the impacts those policies will have on them. So without objection, the letter is entered into the record that I sent you yesterday. So Secretary Yellen, will you commit to providing that legislative text within 30 days to the committee?
Chairman Smith, yesterday the Treasury Department published the so-called Green Book, giving a great deal of detail about all of the proposed changes on the revenue side in this year's budget. And I believe that provides the detail that is necessary to consider these proposals. The Treasury Department always stands ready to work with this committee and members of Congress on tax legislation as you consider it. And of course, we stand ready to do that.
Yeah, I've looked at the Green Book, and we appreciate you all giving it to us yesterday afternoon. It does not provide the legislative text of the tax proposals of $4.7 trillion that your budget calls for. And so what we were asking for the legislative text, so you're not going to send us the legislative text in 30 days?
I don't believe that has ever been done.
I was just
Congress
asking,
usually,
but okay.
As I say, we stand ready to work with you as you consider particular proposals, and we'll certainly look at legislative language and give you our feedback.
But if you will present the legislative text to us on your $4.7 trillion in tax proposals, we'd be happy to look at that. And we hope that since that's in your budget, you'll ask that. Last year, Democrats in Congress rammed through $80 billion in mandatory funding for the IRS after your department asked for it, in conjunction with the president's first budget proposal. Your plan called for the IRS to monitor nearly every American bank account, to hire 87,000 new employees, and to audit over 1 million more Americans each year, with the majority falling on working class Americans. The IRS still hasn't given me the plan for the $80 billion and how that $80 billion will be spent. Even though we have sent several letters, we've spoken on the phone about that. But that can't be right, Secretary Yellen, that you all don't have a plan yet. Your budget request that was submitted yesterday asked for $14.1 billion in annual appropriations for fiscal year 2024. But that's not all, Secretary. Buried on page 209 of that Green Book that you just highlighted, which explains your proposals, Treasury is asking for an additional $29.1 billion in mandatory funding to, quote, continue IRA-funded enforcement and compliance initiatives and investments. None of that money is dedicated to customer service or IT modernization. Obviously, you all have a plan. You're already funding enforcement and compliance initiatives that have not been disclosed to Congress and the American public. You already got $80 billion for the IRS. Now you want $43.2 billion more, all without explaining what will be done with the first $80 billion. The American people, they deserve to know how their hard-earned tax dollars are being spent and the impact that a supercharged IRS will have on them. So how many more IRS agents will this $43.2 billion get us?
So first let me say that the strategic operating plan that we have promised to deliver, we will deliver in the
And you'll make that
weeks.
Public to us.
Yes, it will be provided to you.
Thank you.
In the coming weeks. And already we've taken very important steps to improve customer service. The IRS has hired 5,000 additional customer service representatives. I promised that the average level of service in answering taxpayer inquiries this tax season would rise to 85%. And while it varies from week to week so far, we are certainly in that 80 to 90% range. Tax assistance centers are up and operating. Ones that had been closed due to lack of resources are in the process of being reopened. And many of these centers are open on Saturdays to provide help to consumers. Anyone this tax season, any American attempting to get help from the IRS is experiencing a very different environment.
That's good. So, Secretary, audits is something that people really care about. Will there be increased audits on working class families with this new appropriations?
I have directed already that IRA resources will not be used to increase the share of households or small businesses earning less than $400,000 or less that are audited relative to historic levels. And I promise and will ensure that that mandate will be met. And let's remember—
So that's great news. That's great news, Secretary. That's one common thing that we will have. But part of our oversight duties will be make sure that there's not an increased audits for small businesses and working families. I do want to go on. We are getting close to 2 years since ProPublica revealed that it had obtained what is called a vast trove of IRS data, including extensive information on the tax returns of thousands of Americans, sufficient to detail their income, taxes, investments, and even the results of audits. You've been asked several times about this issue in public, and always note that you've referred the matter to the Inspector General and the Department of Justice for review. You've also said previously that you take this very seriously, but this is not an issue that can be referred elsewhere and then completely ignored. The American people, they deserve to know that their confidential information is safe at the IRS, and they deserve answers about what happened. Other than refer the matter elsewhere, what actions have you taken in the last 20 months to identify and fix potential vulnerabilities in how the IRS maintains confidential taxpayer information?
Listen, I want to say that I shared the same frustration that you're expressing. I would really like to get to the bottom of this. We care deeply about taxpayer privacy, and an unauthorized disclosure of taxpayer information is illegal and something to be taken very seriously. I'm frustrated because we have taken the actions that are appropriate, namely to refer this matter to the appropriate independent investigators. And that includes Treasury's Office of Inspector General, the Treasury Inspector General for Tax Administration, and the Department of Justice. All of these agencies conduct their investigations independently, and according to timelines they determine are necessary and appropriate for a complete investigation. I am waiting to see, just as you are, what the outcome of those investigations
are. So you've done no internal audits within Treasury yourself to see if there might have been any kind of leak or any kind of vulnerabilities in protecting taxpayers' confidential information?
These are the agencies that are independent and—
So you're letting them do it?
That's what is appropriate.
Okay,
in this
thank
situation.
You, Madam Secretary. As you know, we've established a portal to allow IRS employees to share information with this committee about any kind of conduct that's going on at the IRS that they think that we should know of, since we're the Committee of Jurisdiction for Oversight. I sent a letter to the IRS and asked that it be shared with all IRS employees. the agency has thus far refused to do so. That is completely unacceptable. IRS employees should know the options they have to report wrongdoing to Congress that they may witness at work. This is a simple issue. It's about basic transparency and accountability. Will you commit to sharing information about our IRS whistleblower portal with IRS employees?
Well, I want to say that we have very strong whistleblower
protections. No, that's what I've heard, but my question is will you share our whistleblower with the IRS employees, yes or no?
I think what is important is that IRS employees know what their full options are, and they certainly can report to this committee. They can report to other committees.
But will you share this whistleblower information to your IRS employees, yes or no?
I will make sure that they have the appropriate information, that they know what their obligations are and their full set of obligations.
So does that include this whistleblower hotline? Does that include this whistleblower hotline, that's something you'll share with them?
I will make sure that they know all of the options that they have.
Does that include this whistleblower hotline?
It includes this committee, certainly.
And this whistleblower hotline? It's yes or no.
We'll make sure that they are aware.
I hope that you do, for the sake of the American public and for the sake of your IRS employees. On February 16th of this year, President Biden issued an executive order on advancing racial equity through the federal government. That was on February 16th. Treasury Department officials have repeatedly said they want to design tax compliance around racial equity. These statements create the implication that the IRS should take into consideration race and gender in how it manages tax compliance and decides who to audit. But tax returns do not ask taxpayers to identify themselves by race. So the IRS doesn't even have the data on race. That's where the president's executive order comes in. The order instructs the federal government to apply an equity focus to several areas, including to, quote, prevent and remedy discrimination, including by protecting the public from various discrimination. It seems clear that this executive order is instructing the IRS to change its process to make audit decisions based on taxpayers' race. Secretary Yellen, do you think there is any circumstance where the IRS should consider a person's race or gender when deciding whether someone should be audited?
The IRS doesn't know an individual's race, and we are certainly not proposing that race be reported on tax returns. However, the IRS does need to be careful to ensure that there is fairness in tax administration. And when studies like some that have recently been published suggest that algorithms that the IRS may be using are racially biased in the sense they are much more likely to audit, for example, taxpayers of color rather than others with exactly similar circumstances. It's important for the IRS to become aware of that and to make sure that the procedures that they use are fair. But that certainly does not mean looking at race and deciding to whom to audit.
So in regards to audits and fairness, you'll never use race or gender in deciding audits?
Race is not available, and As I said, it's important for the IRS to make sure that their tax administration
is fair. If race isn't available, your statement about the algorithmics that goes after racial preferences.
Well, the investigators were able to infer that the algorithm had that impact in spite of the fact that they weren't certain what the race was of any particular individual. They used methods to infer that. And this is a more general matter that algorithms are often used. They're sometimes used by those who provide credit. They're not based on race, but it may turn out that they're indirectly and unintentionally using race, and it's important to understand and correct that when it's occurring.
Without objection, the President's executive order is entered into the record, and I recognize the gentleman from Massachusetts.
So, Madam Secretary, I'm only going to ask you to use your time to explain some of those positions. I know you have to get out of here, but I want to make sure everybody gets a chance to ask a question on both sides this morning. That's really important. I've questioned Treasury Secretaries back to Nick Brady. Never did I ever ask a yes or no question, because I know events shift and change every single day, and the people that have had that job have been entirely competent over these years. So could you talk a bit about the child credit and also the 311,000 new jobs that were created this morning?
Yes, the child credit. So the child credit, tax credit, was expanded in the American Rescue Plan, that was important because the pandemic especially hit low-income families very hard. And it had a dramatic effect in lowering child poverty, according to many studies. It really helped families. Many families were able to use that child credit to get back to work, to help with child care. The great majority of families that received the child tax credit were working families. Others were seniors taking care of a grandchild or sometimes children with disabilities, and it had a dramatic effect in helping families that were impacted by the pandemic. That's the president believes that this is something that should be in place permanently, and his budget recommends reinstating the credit on the terms it existed in the ARP. You mentioned about this morning's employment report. It showed 311,000 jobs this morning. In spite of that, the unemployment rate ticked up slightly to 3.6%. How to reconcile those two disparate facts? I guess I would point out that there was an increase, the labor force participation rate moved up just a tad, which is always encouraging to see people coming back into the labor force. At this point, the labor force participation rates for both adult men and women have exceeded their pre-pandemic highs. And so when more people come into the labor force, that loosens conditions ever so slightly, takes some of the, helps address some of the supply-demand imbalance in the labor market while creating lots of jobs. So what we're seeing here is a continued, very strong labor market putting Americans back to work.
Thank you, Madam Secretary. And we are always delighted to have the Treasury Secretary in front of the Ways and Means Committee, understanding that you are a successor to Hamilton. Thank you.
Thank you. I look at his picture in my office every day.
The gentleman from Florida, Mr. Buchanan, is recognized.
Madam Secretary, thanks for being here today. My concern is when you look back over the last 20 years, over $20 trillion in debt. So I want to talk to you a little bit about the balance sheet. Also, this financial report that gets put out last couple of years, you signed it. And so I'd like to get your thoughts on exactly, is it a clean opinion? What you said, it's unsustainable, the financial path that we're on. That's what you mentioned in the report. It doesn't seem like it's a very clean audit. I think there's obviously, just in terms of the overall debt, $31 trillion, $20 trillion in the last 20 years. There's plenty of blame, let's put it that way, to go around. But I'm very, very concerned about where we're at and where we're going. I've got two kids and nine grandkids, and a lot of us have children in here. And I'm, as someone, a top economist said to me, at some point this ends badly. You're the way I look at it, the chief financial officer. You know, we get over here and raise the debt. But looking back over the 20 years, I have absolutely no confidence in the way we do business up here. So I'd like to get your thoughts just quickly. What did you mean by unsustainable path that we're on currently as a result of something that you'd put in the financial report? What does that mean to you?
Well, a sustainable path is one that keeps the, in my view, the interest expense on the debt that Americans have to pay. We take in tax revenue. Some of it needs to be devoted to paying interest on outstanding debt.
How do you explain $20 trillion?
It's critical that it be manageable.
Excuse me. How do you explain $20 trillion in 20 years? I mean, we just keep piling up the debt. 100 basis points on $31 trillion is $300 billion a year. I mean, we're kidding ourselves. So if you're at 5, 6% thinking about raising rates, you're talking a trillion and a half just interest alone. So I think it's a concern. Let me just jump to the second question quickly. Is $1 trillion, they're talking about tax increases on small business. That's the proposed budget in terms of pass-through entities. I'm very concerned. That puts the American dream clearly at risk. So 39.5, you add up the other things, you're probably 46. If you figure in New York, New Jersey, I'm in Florida, Texas, you look a little differently, or California, you're close to 60% for pass-through entities. These are small businesses for the most part, 50 employees or less. And it's obvious to me personally that many of you have never been in business because you'd understand that the cost of capital, it's not available for a lot of these small businesses, especially in the environment we're in today. A lot of people are concerned. But how do you think about the idea of another $1 trillion on our small business, medium-sized businesses?
The president pledged not to raise taxes on any individual or small business earning under $400,000.
Well, I'm just saying that if someone's
There's not a single penny.
Let me just finish on this point. If someone's got 100 employees and they make $600-700, the business does, they take out 100, they pay their taxes and they have a few bucks, they could help their balance sheet. And that's the reality in the small business world. Just because as a small business you make 600 doesn't mean you take that home. You need that money to grow. That's the fuel to grow your business. With that, I yield back.
Gentleman from Texas is recognized.
Madam Secretary, I admire your courage in going to Ukraine, and I'm glad you're battle-tested for coming here to our committee. Let me ask you, I'm hopeful that the Republicans will get to us their budget plan in 30 days, just as they've asked for commitments from you to do things within 30 days. They seem to think that we can continue to deal with our debt problems by removing revenue from our vital public services. And I want to touch on two areas that I think the President and you have acted most appropriately to sustain our needs. One of those is for Medicare. They say belatedly now that they won't cut Medicare, but they seem unwilling to make the changes that are necessary to sustain Medicare for our grandchildren as well as for our current seniors. I introduced legislation last year concerning the net investment income tax, and I have reintroduced it, and I see that's included in the President's budget. Isn't it correct that the estimates are that about 85% of that increase would be paid by those who earn $1 million or more a year, and that none of the tax burden would be on those below $400,000?
That's correct. And the proposal wouldn't raise it on anyone making under $400,000, and the revenue would be devoted to Medicare, to shoring up the hospital trust fund.
And the president, I believe, has a plan to extend it even beyond 2040, just closing the loophole and correcting the mistake that was made about the net investment income would extend Medicare solvency to 2040. So if people really believe in Medicare, they'll be willing to take the steps to ensure it's there. And of course, the second one, and it mystifies me at the creativity of our Republican colleagues in coming up for excuses to defend multinationals for not paying their fair share for our national security, though they benefit from it perhaps more than any other group in our society. So I admire your leadership on the global minimum tax. This newest excuse we've heard this morning is that it's going to all help China. They helped China yesterday with their China Bond First program, but tell me about why it is an error to claim that China will somehow benefit from stopping the race to the bottom.
China will not benefit at all from this. China will be forced to raise their minimum tax on their multinationals up to the level of 15% on a country-by-country basis. And China has signed on to the agreement, but if for any reason China failed to enact this tax and put it in place, there is an enforcement mechanism built into this agreement by which the United States or other countries in which Chinese firms do business, where they have subsidiaries doing business, we would impose a top-up tax on Chinese corporations operating in the United States or in Europe, where they've already put the tax into place. So if China doesn't tax these firms, their multinationals, we will do it and we'll keep the tax revenue. But one way or another, we will level the playing field so Chinese firms are on the same footing as our multinationals.
Thank you for your leadership.
Thank you.
Gentleman from Nebraska is recognized.
Thank you. Thank you, Secretary Yellen. Our time is short here, so I'll try to be quick in answering some very concise questions. We have serious concerns about the impact that the $80 billion that the IRS is receiving and its impact on families and small businesses. There are concerns about the funding stemming from the fact that we're working from disparate statements from the administration. So I'm glad you're here to help clarify. 2021, the Treasury released an analysis right here that states $80 billion in additional IRS funding would be used to increase the total headcount at IRS compared to 2021 by almost 87,000 employees over the next decade. Is that accurate? Is that correct?
The vast majority of those hires are to replace attrition, people who would be retiring. So
okay, so the attrition is about 12,000 personnel over the last 10 years.
No, over 10 years, it's much larger than that.
Okay, the record reflects that the headcount decreased by 12,000 over the last decade. So that would leave us at 75,000 new personnel at IRS. So I just want the record to reflect that. Now, regarding the audits, and the chairman talked a bit about this, there's been confusion about the meaning of the directive that you cited in the letter last August and then repeated here today. So are you talking about the total number of audits, or are you talking about the proportion of audits on families and small businesses under $400,000?
I'm talking about the proportion of those small businesses and families.
Okay, so the proportion, I mean, just for the record, the proportion is 90%. So 90% of the new audits will be, you know, according to the data, that we can expect up to 90% of new audits to be on those making less than $400,000.
The purpose of this legislation is to vastly increase the audit rates
on
high income, high wealth,
right,
complex partnerships.
But the data reflects that it's broader than that, especially given the number of personnel. But shifting gears,
the number of taxpayers
I understand.
Earning less than $400,000 increases the audit rates.
The rates
and risk
of audit
will not
the rates of audit and the commitments, you know, are certainly, I believe, very clear. Shifting gears, critical mineral requirements in the Inflation Reduction Act refer to, and I quote, countries with which the United States has a free trade agreement in effect, end quote. As chairman of this panel's trade subcommittee, I've been surprised to hear the Biden administration may take the view that the term, quote, free trade agreement, end quote, is undefined and actually open to various interpretations. So this committee has jurisdiction over all U.S. trade policies, including the negotiation and enforcement of trade agreements. We know exactly what a free trade agreement is, as do our partners, our trading partners, who have actually raised concerns about the Inflation Reduction Act. So, Secretary Yellen, please clarify, would you define a free trade agreement or at least provide a list of countries with whom we have a free trade agreement?
Well, we clearly have a number of comprehensive free trade agreements that will qualify as free trade agreements for the purposes of this statute. But in December, Treasury issued a white paper that lays out a possible approach to identifying additional agreements that could potentially qualify. And we understand that the key goal of the IRA is to strengthen supply chains we rely on for energy and resources. And in order to effectuate the goals of the legislation, it may be appropriate to negotiate.
I understand what the IRA is intended to do. I fear what the actual impact will be, and my time has expired.
Gentleman from California is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And Madam Secretary, thank you for being here and welcome. I have a couple of things I want to bring up, but first I want to be really clear. You were confirmed Secretary in January of 2021. This January, we hit the lowest unemployment rate in 50 years. We went from unprecedented pandemic to the lowest unemployment in decades, and you oversaw all of it. And today, as we heard, 311,000 new jobs in February. As Mr. Neal highlighted, your incredible resume and your history, you are truly a pro. Over the past couple years, I've been privileged to work directly with you as we transition to clean and renewable energy. And I want to thank you for your cooperation and
thank
your
you.
Help. I've got
thank
four
you.
Items I want to bring up. We have a limited amount of time, so I'll ask two and write you about the other. I'd like to talk to you about my top two priorities, disaster relief and mental health, and I'll start with disaster relief. Madam Secretary, many survivors of California's wildfires in 2015, 17, and 18 are eligible for compensation from something called the Fire Victims Trust, which established following the Pacific Gas and Electric bankruptcy. However, in many of these cases, the survivors are being forced to pay taxes on a settlement award they received from the trust, including roughly 30% of the award that goes to attorneys. I have a bipartisan, bicameral legislation clarifying that disaster relief payments like these from a trust fund are straightforwardly non-taxable. And I'd like you to work with us and your people to work with us so we can help these folks who haven't even received enough money to rebuild the homes that they lost. Yep. And then second, I think the biggest issue, the second biggest issue that we face as a people is mental health. We see problems everywhere, schools, homelessness, veterans, amongst the elderly. Mental illness is a huge, huge problem that costs us trillions of dollars, and we need to figure it out. But treating the symptoms as we've done isn't enough, nor do we have all the money to do it. We have to get ahead of the curve. And Mr. Kelly and I have bipartisan legislation that we're getting ready to reintroduce, and we shared it with your staff, that provides tax incentives for neurological research. Madam Secretary, do you agree that we can and should use the tax code to help address our collective mental health crisis?
Well, these are critically important problems and, to me, appropriate priorities. And let me say that we will be more than happy to work with you on this legislation. So my staff can certainly be in touch.
Thank you. And then I'll submit my questions about solar cells and taxpayer correspondence to you in writing. Again, thank you for the incredible job that you've done and your commitment to public service. Thank you
for your kind words. Much appreciated.
Gentleman from Pennsylvania is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Madam Secretary, thanks for being here. And you do have an impressive resume.
Thank you.
And your dedication to the public and trying to do everything you can when it comes to the economy is really great. I got to tell you, I live at a much different level. And there's an old saying, if you can't convince them, confuse them. Now, being in the retail automobile business all my life, I'm better on blacktop than I am on a laptop. And as we go here and we throw these questions out to you, I keep coming back to some of the things I've learned in my past life. And, you know, one of the things is you read The Tale of Two Cities, and this is what we're talking about, right? It's the best of times, it's the worst of times. We talk about job creation. It's not job creation, it's job recovery. And I heard this not in the Trump administration, but the previous administration. We used to talk about how many jobs we created, and what it really was is we were just getting people back to work that were no longer working, and some of the decisions we've made made it more valuable for people to stay at home than go to work. And it wasn't that people were lazy, it's just that they weren't stupid. You have a tough job. You have a tough job. And I often refer to things that just happen in my life and in everyday things. I can remember a movie called A Few Good Men, and I think one of the things that Jack Nicholson said in that movie was, you can't handle the truth. I'm not talking about you, but I'm talking about the American people. Mr. Buchanan touched on this, and we worry about this all the time. It is the public debt, which is part of your job description. And you really answer to the President of the United States as a member of the cabinet. I am just baffled as where we go from here and how we can put a smile on our faces, because the people I talk to aren't in this room. When I come out of Mass in the morning, I have people that stop me. When I go to Canella's to have breakfast, people stop me. When I go to Cummings to get coffee, people stop me. You know what they ask me all the time? When the hell are you guys going to get this thing straightened out? My pension now is losing its value. I'm dipping into my savings. I can't help my kids and my grandkids anymore because my wife and I don't have the ability to keep up with inflation. So I know we have all these wonderful, wonderful programs that we talk about and all these wonderful ideas that we talk about, and it just is bizarre to me that I think we need to spend more time in the field. We need to go to Petersburg, West Virginia. We need to go to Oklahoma, and we need to talk to people who really service the debt, and that is our hardworking American taxpayers. I think all of us, while we have questions of you, I got to tell you, I don't know that I would want your job. I don't know that I wouldn't be there and wondering where the slap is going to come from next. But you do one heck of a job. I would just hope that as a committee, we don't look at how it is that we can make each other look bad or to figure out who struck John, but to understand that it is the American people that are suffering right now. This idea of not looking into ProPublica, and I understand what you said, is somebody else's thing, and I got to tell you, I got 10 grandchildren, so this reminds me of Humpty Dumpty. Humpty Dumpty sat in a wall. Humpty Dumpty had a great fall. All the king's horses and all the king's men couldn't put Humpty Dumpty back together again. So you just outlined for us the number of offices, the number of people we have to get to a simple answer is, who the hell put the information out there? How did they get this information? And the longer we stay away from an answer, the faith, the trust, and the confidence of the American people in this institution is withering and dying on the vine. I would just suggest to all of us, I don't give a shit if you wear a red hat or a blue hat. Wear something that's red, white, and blue, and look at how it is that you represent back home. Because I love sitting here and listening to all the testimony. What I have a hard time is when I go back home and saying, we're working on it. We just don't know who's going to answer the question for you. Thank you so much. I appreciate you being here. Your patience and your dedication to this country is phenomenal. Thank you, ma'am.
Gentleman from Connecticut is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Madam Secretary, for being here. And thank you also for being part of an administration that actually did leave the country with a surplus. Mr. Neal yesterday very eloquently went through that process. So I think the American people and even our colleagues over here on this side of the aisle, we point with great pride your example, your leadership that you have demonstrated, including
Thank you.
The 12 million new jobs that have been created in just the past 2 years. Also wanted to, because there's a lot of talk about fairness and debt, et cetera, and I am now the ranking member of the Social Security Subcommittee, and Social Security, as you know, is the nation's number one anti-poverty program for the elderly, and hopefully we get the child tax credit back, but absent that, it's the number one anti-poverty program for children as well. I commend the president for his budget that increases the opportunity and makes Medicare more solvent and also strengthens Social Security. And it does so actually by paying for it. And the president in his comments said, and you pointed to this, that there will be no tax increase on anyone over $400,000. How many Americans does that represent? How many people are in that area of earning over $400,000? And is it fair that someone who's making $30,000 or $50,000 or $75,000 pays in the whole time and someone like Elon Musk stops paying after day one for their Social Security? Isn't this about fairness?
I think it is about fairness, and I think hardworking Americans who have counted on Social Security and paid into it their entire lives and dependent on it as their major source of income in retirement, I think we need to make sure that it's there for them and that we look for additional revenue to Americans with very high incomes, many of whom in total pay less taxes than a teacher or a firefighter. And throughout the president's budget, there are many proposals to make sure, for the sake of tax fairness, that those individuals pay at least a minimum. A person making $100 million or more should pay at least 25% of their full income as taxes. But yes, I think it's for
like,
tax fairness.
Like Mr.
Critical.
Kelly, I go to a lot of places, and everywhere I go, they ask me, when are we going to fix Social Security? And why is it that I have to pay in, and we learned from the president and this exchange, why do I have to pay in constantly out of every paycheck? It's called FICA, Federal Insurance Contribution, and the wealthy do not.
Agreed.
The only floor vote of the day has been called. As there is only one vote, we will keep the hearing going on. So please vote and then return to the hearing immediately. Gentleman from Arizona.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Madam Secretary. The nature of the chaos of what we all do. We only have 3.5 minutes, so the tyranny of the clock. When you have high-profile elected members who will say things, because I have an incredible and concern of messaging and stability in debt markets around the world, when we will say things like, debt doesn't matter, print a trillion-dollar coin, modern monetary policy, we can just keep borrowing. Is that helpful as we're trying, and particularly when you're looking at your subscription rates and your auctions? Do you wish on occasion we would just not talk about things we don't understand?
Well, look, I think it's critical that the United States be on a fiscal path that's responsible and sustainable.
And I know this is more of a message from our brothers and sisters here, particularly. I have a long list of quotes about debt not mattering from my brothers and sisters on the left, and I think that's a really horrible messaging to debt markets when, you know, you and I were trying to convince the world we take this very seriously.
I think we should take it seriously, and it does matter.
In your banking reg side of Treasury, any concerns over some of the stresses right now in bond markets, particularly, you know, your Basel holdings, Silicon Valley Bank, when, you know, mark to market, are you picking up any data that we should be at least cognizant of?
Well, I will just say you mentioned Silicon Valley Bank. There are recent developments that concern a few banks that I'm monitoring very carefully. And when banks experience financial losses, it is and should be a matter of concern.
To explain, it's the nature of moving interest rates. All of a sudden, if you have to sell the bonds, you're taking quite a loss. In the budget, Madam Secretary, you have a little bit less than $5 trillion of new taxes over the 10 years. Do you have the wherewithal to model that, to say, okay, here's our tax regime, and here's its economic effect on GDP growth? Were you able to do modeling documents?
Well, we don't have a gigantic model that shows what the total impact would be on the economy, but we've certainly considered the economic impact in the case of all of the policies that proposed.
I spent part of my evening, that's why I'm glassy-eyed, trying to read through. I was looking for saying, okay, we're going to raise this much taxes, and we believe it has this much impairment on GDP growth over the 10. If one of your staffers ever could send me a document, I'd love to look at your math.
There are studies, and it is something that we've tried to evaluate in putting forward proposals.
Last thing, your capital gains tax would go up to what? For very high earners?
It would go up to the same rate as the tax on regular income.
Okay, so it matched regular income, though
high-income individuals.
Madam Secretary, but in the current environment, capital gains are substantially affected by inflation. So we would be taxing non-actual gains. We would be taxing inflated gains, inflation gains, not actual appreciation. Should we actually do an adjustment for inflation on those capital gains taxes?
It's something certainly to consider. I mean, our tax code is in general not
inflation neutral.
This is an area that maybe requires some
thought. Thank you, Madam Secretary, and thank you for your patience, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Representative. Gentleman from Oregon.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Madam Secretary, for being here. When I consider the tone with which you were greeted, I'm amazed that you are willing to come back and your patience. It's not just your resume, it's your performance.
Thank you.
You have one of the most difficult jobs in America, and every American has a stake in your success.
Thank you.
Yesterday's action by this committee, coming up with this fantasy that somehow the IRS can prioritize 1.28 million, excuse me, billion, payments a year to try and sidestep our responsibility to raise the debt limit. I apologize for that. It continues a trend that my Republican friends have had for years in terms of making the IRS job more difficult, fewer people, and more complex returns. I'm hopeful that we can get past that and that we're able to engage with you in a constructive way to avoid economic catastrophe. I do have one modest area of disagreement, and I must agree with my dear friend Chairman Smith about some of the suggestions that we can sidestep working with Congress and redefine agreements as FTAs. None of us think that satisfies the condition. I've worked with five presidents on trade issues, and when we do not have a good, constructive working relationship and Congress playing its role, it doesn't end well. And I would just refer the trade promotion, the TPP, as an example where it was harder, and we're still bearing the circumstances.
I apologize for any suggestion that I may have made that Congress doesn't have an appropriate role.
But in terms of redefining what a what the terms are going to be, it's in effect sidestepping us. I think
we have been in close touch with this committee.
Yes, I
my staff
that,
have but been.
But it's different than treating our statutory and constitutional responsibilities. I would just hope that you would commit to work with me and Chairman Smith as we move forward in a way that's fully consistent with the true definition of a free trade agreement and the spirit of cooperation in terms of trying to get us on the same wavelength. I think your objectives are ones that I probably agree with, but process matters, and in terms of being able to make sure that the various stakeholders, some of whom don't have the confidence in terms of the path that you're taking, I think working together, we can raise that confidence, we can work together to get the desired objectives, and I hope that you would commit to working with us in not just the spirit, but the letter of what free trade agreements are.
I will make that commitment, and I agree with you that that collaboration and consultation is critically important. We are committed to it.
Thank you. I look forward to working with you and your team, who are doing a great job in trying to figure out how to implement the things that Chairman Thompson and I embedded in the tax code that has a challenge for you, but
thank
we appreciate
you.
The
Thank you. We're
work.
Working very hard to implement the green credits and IRA and all of the IRA provisions.
It's much appreciated.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Gentleman from Illinois is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Welcome, Secretary Yellen. Thank you for your service to the country. We hope to see more of you here before our committee. I have a question for you, but before I do that, I do want to express to you how extremely disappointed I am in the administration's budget proposal released yesterday. As I think about the 750,000 constituents that I represent in Central Illinois and Northwest Illinois, I can tell you that their priorities are vastly different than what's reflected in the administration's budget proposal. Just to highlight a few things, eliminating the stepped-up basis would really crush family farms in my district and family-owned businesses. Quadrupling the recently created stock buyback tax, which will hurt Americans with 401k plans and pensions, is in there, and expanding the net investment income tax on small businesses that are still struggling with high inflation and workforce shortages, again, is disappointing when I look at the budget. It is clear that many of the real challenges that Americans are facing are not being heard by this administration and in this budget. To my question, I do want to just, it was referenced earlier, I do want to talk about the OECD process and the current global tax negotiations, and specifically Pillar 1, Madam Secretary. We understand that negotiations around Pillar 1 have stalled, and I believe we have significant risk that digital service taxes, which disproportionately harm U.S. businesses, will spread across the world. We've already seen that. Republicans have repeatedly requested from the administration and from you to consult with us before making decisions about your negotiations with our European counterparts. You have not done so in terms of communicating with us, and it's been a source of frustration. You've not provided any analysis that would allow members of this committee to evaluate the effects of Pillar 1. So, Madam Secretary, as you sit here today, I think you would agree that it is not financially responsible to purchase a product without knowing its price, and that's the real core here. So when can Congress expect to see this analysis so that we know what we are actually being sold here?
So let me say that we have consulted and with this committee and with staff on a regular basis about these global negotiations. So we are keeping staff of this committee, our staff is keeping committee staff well informed.
Well, reclaiming my time on just on that point, Madam Secretary, we are looking for an analysis. I would love to have, if you have an analysis here today, you can supply us.
Let me respond on that point. What we've said is that we stand to gain substantially in Pillar 1 because we're a very large market jurisdiction, and that means that we will get increased taxing power. However, there are also provisions on which we will lose, and it's a very fine balance. Zero is certainly a possibility with respect to revenue, and there remain significant disagreements in the Pillar One negotiations. Until those are resolved, we can't do the analysis that you want, but what we have said is that the likely impact on U.S. revenues, while it could be slightly positive or slightly negative, depending on the details, it is not likely to be large.
Well, I would just say the premise of what you just said there and the justification for that sounds great, but an analysis on there that we can digest and look at and work with your team is what we need. Thank you.
Thank the gentleman. The gentleman from New Jersey, Mr. Pascarell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Madam Secretary, a Stanford University report found that black taxpayers are disproportionately audited by the IRS. I'm sure you've read that report. Now, this was true for earned income tax credit recipients, and this group is long overrepresented in getting audited. The numbers show that. I'm thrilled we have a new IRS commissioner to effectively implement the Inflation Reduction Act to close the tax gap and rebuild a fair tax enforcement. Yesterday, our Oversight Subcommittee called on Mr. Werfel to prioritize fixing our biased and broken two-tier tax system. Madam Secretary, will you commit to addressing racial disparities in audit selection?
Yes, absolutely we will. We need a tax system that operates fairly. And as you noted, our new IRS commissioner has promised to report back to Congress on this matter very promptly.
Will you ensure the IRS uses Inflation Reduction Act funds to stop disproportionately auditing EITC recipients and focus on auditing other folks in the system as well?
The focus of the funds in the IRA is intended to be high income, high wealth, complex partnerships, corporations where audit rates have fallen to extremely low levels and where most of the revenue that constitutes the tax gap, we know that's where it lies. That is the focus on enforcement. But on the EITC, there are high rates of improper payments,
right,
partly because improperly file for EITC for low-income individuals, and we do need to attend to that. So it's not the fault of individuals, but there is an issue there that we need to continue to focus on, maybe through education and outreach.
You've provided tremendous service to our country.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, I want to bring to your attention the fact that there is a member of the cabinet sitting before us who admits mistakes once in a while. I've never met a cabinet member that made a mistake, sorry. I say that with due respect.
Thank you.
And I think that's refreshing. And I think that helps bring us together more than anything else. Anything else. I'm serious. And I'm happy to do work with you. And you've done a great job.
Thank you so much. Much appreciated.
I'd like to thank the gentleman from New Jersey. Now I recognize the gentleman from Ohio, Mr. Winster.
Thank you. Mr. Pascarell, I'd like to agree that honesty really does help, no matter what we're dealing with. Anyway, thank you, Madam Secretary, for being here. The Tax Cuts and Jobs Act verifiably led to more American jobs, historically low unemployment, stable revenues, higher wages, and COVID hit. And one of the things that COVID revealed to us was the vulnerability of our supply chain and how it's a national security risk, it's a national health risk. Just look at where we get our pharmaceuticals from. It's sure. China. We can't do it ourselves. We're trying to come back from that. So my question is, how does raising corporate tax rate to a higher level than the People's Republic of China, for that matter, almost any other country in the world, how can that make America more competitive and solve our supply chain problem?
Well, I believe it really is important that we invest in America so we can be a competitive economy. And you mentioned the importance of tax rules to private investment in equipment and software. But I guess I would point out, and this is what I mean when I use the term modern supply-side economics, there are quite a few other kinds of investments that are relevant to our productivity and competitiveness, and we also need to focus on those. So infrastructure is an example. Education
is
another
example. I agree with that. You've got to have all those things in place. And you call them investments or whatever, but also I think that making the business feasible here compared to somewhere else makes a big difference. And that's what we have to consider as well. We've had no inversions since the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act, and I don't want to see that go away. But also, we talk about lowest unemployment now, and it's so low, but the NFIB says half of their small businesses have help wanted signs out. Virtually every business I go to now, small employer, large employer, they said, what's your biggest problem? It's getting workers.
Agreed.
Okay, so we have, could you explain, not only for me, because I think I have a good idea, but explain to the American people and explain to these businesses why, with such low unemployment, they don't have employees.
Well, I mean, that's partly what the problem is that the demand for workers in this economy...
Where'd they go? They had the workers before COVID.
Well, the COVID pandemic accelerated retirements. We have seen labor force participation for both adult men and women rise above previous levels. And the president's budget focuses on providing households the child care and other support they need to work. And I think it's really important to boost labor supply. And the president's budget is focused.
So my point is, it's not completely honest if we just say, hey, unemployment's low. Well, yeah, but it's still a problem to get employees. So we can't pretend there's a rosy picture. We've got to address all these other issues.
It is a problem that most businesses face and are trying to deal with.
Thank you. I yield back. Appreciate it.
Gentleman from Illinois is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Madam Secretary. And I thank President Biden for prioritizing policies that would provide meaningful relief to Americans, both young and old. I deeply appreciate the recognition that making the adoption tax credit refundable is essential to removing income as a barrier to adoption. I thank the President for advancing an even greater child tax credit to lift even more children out of poverty. The CTC was a lifetime in my communities, and its absence makes children more vulnerable. I also want to thank you for prioritizing the improvements to the earned income tax credit that I have long championed in my responsible fatherhood legislation and for preserving the protections for foster youth and youth experiencing homelessness. I thank you for permanently ending the taxation of forgiven student debt and for all the other policies that would make our country stronger. I hope that you will consider the importance of direct tax credits for child care and rent as supplements to the strong budget you propose. As we saw with the modernized child dependent tax credit in 2021, direct tax credits serve as an essential tool for helping every eligible working parent, our cost burden renter given the limited availability of other assistance such as vouchers or low-income housing. And finally, like other systems in our country, the seemingly race-neutral tax policies and audit practices have a substantial disproportionate impact on taxpayers of color. So I hope to work with you to identify legislation that would collect key demographic information about taxpayers to better understand racial and gender equity. And I thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Do you yield?
No, I will yield, of course, for the Secretary.
Oh, well, certainly the President supports the child tax credit and earned income tax credit and would work with you to consider the child and dependent care credit, which was passed earlier by Congress, but by the House, but isn't in the Green Book proposals, but would certainly look to work with you on that.
Well, thank you for all of your accomplishments. It's certainly a strong budget, and we look forward to continuing to work to make it even stronger. Thank you very much, and I yield back.
Gentleman from Texas is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Madam Secretary. I'm the budget chairman, and we will have a budget. My Democrat colleagues, the last 4 years, did not have a budget. So it's rich when I hear them talk about us presenting a budget. Second thing I want the American people to know is y'all sent your budget late, and so the process is delayed. And we're going to take our time, and I hope you appreciate this, to unpack what's in this massive budget proposal. We're going to analyze it, and we're going to lay it out for the American people. So that will be the process. We will have a budget, and we will be able to compare not just the numbers, but the priorities, the policies, the values, and the vision that we differ on for the future of this country. Quick question, if you could, just a yes or no on this. Does the amount of government spending that we have been pushing out over the last couple of years, about $10 trillion, six of that it will be is borrowed money, that's adding to the debt, about $6 trillion. Does that, has that contributed to this 15 consecutive months of record inflation? And as you I'm sure are aware, inflation that is cutting the budgets of our working families, really devastating poor people and seniors on a fixed income. But is spending contributed to that? Federal government spending contributed to that, yes or no?
Well, I believe that that was critically important support to make sure we didn't end up with a scarred labor force at a time when the risk was we could see.
So is that a yes, that spending, has spending contributed to inflation? Just yes or no? Forget your reasons why. You make that case to the American people. I'll say that the American Rescue Plan that was Democrat-supported, no Republicans, jammed through, was more about bailing out union pensions and paying teachers' unions for schools that never opened our children. We can debate that point.
Well,
does spending contribute to inflation?
I believe that most of the inflation we've experienced reflects disruptions from the pandemic,
Madam Speaker, I mean,
the supply side of the economy.
Madam Secretary, please, and with all due respect, I ask for a simple answer. The American people know that the spending that has flooded the marketplace has created this gap in supply and demand, and it is punishing, as the worst of regressive taxes on all Americans. And here's the insulting thing, and again, with all due respect, this is insulting, that your budget, the president's budget, increases spending. The budget has the highest sustained levels of spending, taxes, and deficits in the history of the United States of America. Now, I will finish on this. You've requested $100 billion more in just discretionary spending. If you do the average amount of spending that you all have requested in the last 3 years, the actual and the requested, we'd be $3 trillion over the $20 trillion that CBO's projecting. It's bankrupting the country, and it's insulting that your budget comes back, you know, your proposal is more of the same.
I'm sorry, there's $3 trillion of deficit reduction over
Nobody
the next 10
that.
Years in this budget.
I appreciate
and
that
there
on
are
paper.
Ways It's one thing to spend when you don't pay for it, and it's another thing to spend when you do. And there are revenue raisers in this budget that more than finance the additional spending.
Y'all have added $6 trillion to the debt, and even if I believe what you put on paper, you're taking off half of that. Only half of the $6 trillion you've added. As if you're trying to give a gift back to them. Here's half of your money back. We're going to help save the country by giving half the money that we borrowed on the backs of our children. I just don't believe it, and I look forward to more conversations, and I appreciate your service.
Recognize the gentlelady from California.
Thank you. Secretary Yellen, thank you so much for joining us here this morning. You have a long and distinguished resume and career, and you are doing a terrific job. We applaud you. I'm sure that as a woman working in a traditionally dominated male field, you're probably no stranger to breaking firsts and paving the way for other women, which is why during Women's History Month, it's disappointing to see some of my colleagues talk down to you, use profanity, and not allow you to finish your answers here at this hearing. And I think it's important to call out that kind of behavior. I want to refute a point that several of my colleagues have made with respect to the lack of workers that somehow my Republican colleagues want to blame the Democrats for. I want to remind my colleagues of a few salient points about the worker shortage. Number one is that prior to the pandemic, we had worker shortages. When I used to meet regularly with my small business owners, they identified that as the number one problem that they were experiencing. And then during COVID, many baby boomers retired during the pandemic, and many are now too old to return back to the workforce. So that's a contributing factor. Additionally, the birth rate in the United States has been falling for years, and it's not at replacement right now. So we don't have the workers coming up because we simply have a lower birth rate. And then I would remind my colleagues on the other side of the aisle that lack of movement on immigration reform that creates legal pathways for immigrants to come to this country also exacerbates the worker shortage. So let's just be real clear about what some of these contributing factors are instead of just blanket blaming Democrats for the lack of workers. It's some of the actual things that are outside of our control, which is demographics, but also things that are within our control, like immigration reform. Secretary Yellen, I wanted to ask you about the Inflation Reduction Act, because Treasury has embarked on some critical mineral agreements with Japan and the European Union. And I understand that the intent is to address their concerns on EV tax credits, but that's not exactly happening in a vacuum. Our allies have said that they will build on their existing climate subsidies in response to the IRA. I think that all of us who helped write this law agree that we need to work with our allies on shared climate goals. But I also want to stress that the unprecedented way these agreements were written, with this exercise, we continue to upend the separation of power on trade authorities. These agreements have been written in a manner that gives the Secretary the power to guarantee specific tax cuts with USTR signing off on your behalf. So I want to focus on those agreements and how they'll affect the domestic union supply chains that we're trying to foster as our partners try to expand their investments. Madam Secretary, California is home to one of the largest untapped lithium reserves in the world, which is close to the Salton Sea. And so how may this select buyers club have the potential to undermine investments back home?
Well, the Inflation Reduction Act creates very strong incentives to produce, develop minerals for batteries in the United States and to develop their capacity to process those minerals. However, the global demand for these minerals in the years to come will be enormous, and we're highly dependent on China. And so we've seen as one of the goals of the IRA to broadly strengthen supply chains for these critical minerals and their processing. And so the agreements that we're discussing with Japan and with Europe would potentially, if it's possible to form such agreements, permit our close allies to also contribute minerals and their processing that would be eligible for use in electric vehicles that are assembled in North America. But this is going to be a vast and growing market, and there are huge incentives for development of minerals in the United States.
Thank you for your answer, and I yield back.
Gentleman from Georgia is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Madam Secretary, for being here today. You know, in early on in your remarks, you threw out a term I had not heard called modern supply-side economics. I did a little quick research on that. I believe you're calling a duck a squirrel. That is nothing more than modern monetary theory, and I would suggest that the American people don't go for that. But anyway, that's not really what I wanted to get to. You know, you've got $80 billion for 87,000 new IRS employees. You're asking for another $43 billion. And, you know, I don't see where those, you know, where the plan for the previous employees are. Number two, how do we know that these employees won't be looking into the bank accounts of our fellow Americans? Our friends on the other side of the aisle tried to get an IRS surveillance program into the banking system in the last Congress, and we successfully blocked it. But we've had to go so far as to introduce a bill, H.R. 1010, prohibiting IRS Financial Surveillance Act. Can we have your assurances that none of the money that has been appropriated to the IRS will be used to implement a financial surveillance system with the banking system, snooping into the bank accounts of our fellow Americans, unless it is directed by Congress? Yes or no? Do we have your commitment that you won't go around the back of Congress and implement that program?
Of course not. We require
good. Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate that, Madam Secretary, and I appreciate the directness of the answer. Second thing, I still don't get the fact that under the Constitution, the power of taxation lies with Congress, and yet you are negotiating U.S. tax policy and you're ceding U.S. tax policy and revenue to countries around the world with the OECD. I will tell you, I've said this, and I think I said this the last time you were here. We are about making America the most competitive place in the world to do business, and we should be winning both on the manufacturing side and the export side. We should be importing treasure from around the world to the United States of America. And I don't think that we should give up one dime of our U.S. revenue to foreign countries with this. When we have a debt crisis that is looming, okay? Real quickly, can you tell me, will the GILTI revenues, if your Pillar 2 is implemented, will those revenues go down here in the U.S.?
Well, if the United States implements the GILTI tax, which would involve...
As a function of Pillar 2, would you see a decrease in tax revenue coming into the U.S. from that?
It would be a huge increase in tax revenue if we implement the GILTI tax.
Okay, I think that's yet to be determined.
Now, one final thing,
Madam Secretary. You know, Americans really, over the years of all of the alphabet agencies up here, they tend to fear the letters IRS more than most. And one of the things that we find disturbing is that the IRS has been buying up a tremendous amount of ammunition and firearms over the years. Two things. Number one, can you provide a report to this body that will explain why the IRS has purchased so much 9mm ammunition, and will you commit to not buying a single bullet or a single gun in that agency until you get your customer service right?
Look, there.
Yes or no? Will you look into that?
No, I won't, because.
Okay, thank you, Madam. My time has expired. Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Thank you. Gentleman from Kansas is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Madam Secretary, over here. We're doing two for one. I'm sorry. Thank you, Madam Secretary, for joining us today. You know, as we were meeting today, you know, we just got the administration's budget yesterday and tried to dig through the numbers and get an understanding. But, you know, just from top line, over the next 10 years, we're spending $8.2 trillion in spending. We're raising in revenue or bringing in revenue $65 trillion, which equates to a corresponding deficit of $17 trillion. Now, I know you said that we're having a $3 trillion cut in the deficit, but just because we're not making a $20 trillion deficit, it's still a $17 trillion increase over the 10-year period. And we talked earlier a little bit about the 15% increase in the department after already getting the $80 billion last year, and with us being in debt, and actually next year, over one out of $4 that is being spent in the 2024 suggested budget is borrowed. It's almost one out of $3 is borrowed, 30% of the spending next year. So today I want to focus a little bit and follow up a little bit on my colleague from Georgia talked about the OECD and particularly talk a little bit about the OECD Pillar 2 and the impact on the U.S. competitiveness in the world. And what's being negotiated is some radical changes in the international tax system. And we've sent a letter to my office, or there was a letter that you sent back to my office indicating you look forward to working with us to implement this. I can tell you that Congress isn't in favor of this. As several of us have mentioned, we have very main concerns, and Congress doesn't want to implement something that will make American weaker and less competitive. So, you know, last year, the Democrat majority in Congress wouldn't even pass the Pillar 1 or the Pillar 2 and OECD provisions. So have you informed the other countries that we're negotiating with that, you know, it wouldn't pass last year and it's probably not going to pass under a Republican Congress this year?
Well, my understanding is that there were members of Congress that did not want the United States to go first in implementing a 15% minimum tax country by country. We already have a 10.5% guilty your minimum tax on earnings of American multinationals abroad. And now the European Union has adopted it and other countries are moving forward. Japan, the United Kingdom, Singapore, many countries are going forward with this. So the issue of are going first and will others follow no longer exists.
Well, it does change though, before I run out of time, if the proposal is to raise our GILTI to 21% when everybody else is doing 15% is all that they have to do, I mean, that's going to make American businesses less competitive.
Well, no,
and,
it's
and
not.
In the meantime, with the under tax provisions, it's going to actually allow other countries to still race to the bottom through this process.
That isn't right, because right now we have a 15% tax and no other country has any tax whatsoever. So there's a 15% gap. Now they're all going to have a 15% gap, and we're proposing that we go to 21, which is a much smaller gap of 6%. We're a competitive, attractive place to do business, and having a lower tax rate on the earnings of American companies abroad than they would pay at home is an incentive to shift jobs out of the United States abroad. And we're more competitive and we're narrowing that gap, which makes it more attractive to invest in the United States.
It really is.
Disadvantage.
We would agree on that, that the U.S. competitiveness is hurt, and that's what was addressed. And I've run out of time, but I'll yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Gentleman from New York.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Madam Secretary, yesterday this committee held a hearing on the technicality of a proposal where there was a lot of talk about debt, deficit, and priorities. At the same time, the President released a $6.9 trillion budget plan, 182-page document. The deficit by $3 trillion over the next decade. Bloomberg Economics put out a comprehensive report last month saying that President Biden was on track to becoming the greatest jobs-producing president in U.S. history. nearly 13 million jobs in the past 26 months, including 504,000 in January, 311,000 that was announced this morning for the month of February. They forecast that while inflation was at 9.1% in June of last year, the forecast for this time next year is 2.25%. 92% of Americans now have access to affordable health care, and we are beginning, through the Inflation Reduction Act, to compete in a real sense with China. You know, the Stone Age didn't end because we ran out of stones, and the oil age won't end because we run out of oil. The oil age will end when we find a way to do it that is cleaner, quicker, and more competitive. The Inflation Reduction Act includes two major pieces. One is a $7,500 tax credit for Americans to purchase electric vehicles, and also a tax credit for American manufacturers of batteries that is estimated to reduce the cost of an electric car by an additional $9,000. It seems as though, you know, we finally got the message that we need to be tough about China, but we need to be tougher on ourselves about China as well. And these initiatives in the Inflation Reduction Act and in this budget, I think, go a long way to doing that. You're the 78th Secretary of the Treasury. You were appointed in January of 2021. And just your thoughts about these and other efforts that are in the budget toward the goal of increasing American competitiveness, accruing to the advantage of the American people and the American consumer.
Well, thank you for your comments. I strongly agree with your assessment of the Inflation Reduction Act. It is already having a dramatic effect on investment in the United States and job creation, and will make us more energy secure and more competitive and deal with the really national security threat that reflects our over-dependence on China for the provision of many, both battery components and electric batteries, solar panels, wind turbines, what we need to be energy secure, to promote clean energy. So this is a huge step. The Semiconductor and Chips Act addresses our dependence in China and reduction in competitiveness in manufacturing semiconductors in the United States, and that's having a huge effect already in job creation. And the Infrastructure Act is really shoring up our competitiveness by finally repairing roads and bridges that are decaying in the United States and really need to be upgraded, and also what's necessary for a modern economy to have digital access all over the country. These bills are shoring up our competitiveness, and the budget will add to the provision of funding for R&D, innovation in the United States, and other things.
Thank you. I yield back.
Gentleman from Pennsylvania is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Madam Secretary, thank you for your service to our country. I was pleased to hear, in response to one of my colleagues' questions earlier, just a little while ago, you said that the debt, these matters, and I quote, should be taken seriously. When you and I talked last year during this hearing, you said, and again, I quote, it is desirable to reduce deficits. Do you still feel that way, Madam Secretary?
Yes, I do. Yeah.
The chart I have here, and I don't know if you can see it, hopefully you can catch it, but this is the next 10 years, and compares the 2023 proposal by the President, budget proposal, and 2024. I have directly from the budget these sheets. And What it shows is that this proposal, 2024 compared to 2023, increases deficits further, year over year. And the orange on here is your new proposal compared to what you were proposing last year. You see some significant difference in the early years, but it never is reduced over the proposals from last year. And on your totals on this sheet, you're proposing over the next 10 years today, $17 trillion in additional deficits and debt, as opposed to 12 months ago, you were proposing $14 trillion total in deficits and debt. So my question is today, why are you proposing $3 trillion higher deficits than you proposed last year?
Well, excuse me. The budget contains a table, table S2, that shows the effect of the budget proposals on projected deficits, and that illustrates.
Do you disagree with my characterization?
I do disagree because what this table shows is that the president's proposals result in additional deficit reduction relative to the 2023 baseline of close to $3 trillion.
Could you point out which year there are?
I can barely see your chart, but I can tell you.
Could you look at your sheet and tell me which year there are lower deficits than what you had proposed last year?
Well, for example, starting in 2025, the projected deficits in the baseline were 6.7%. And in the president's
that was not your baseline last year. That is CBO's baseline, which is far higher than what you were projecting last year. So essentially you're saying our policies created higher deficits than you had projected last year, and now we're going to take credit for reducing those higher deficits by $3 million. Am I right on that? Or $3
trillion? Relative to where we were before this budget was issued, and the deficits that we would have seen, this budget projects.
Nobody outside of the Beltway will look at your proposal compared to the proposals last year. We'll look at your proposal compared to what has actually happened. We'll look at a chart like this, which is taken directly from your numbers, and say that we're reducing the deficit. And it's a shame because we both agree that long term, we're on a wrong fiscal trajectory. We must do something about it, and this budget does nothing. In fact, it adds to the deficits and debts that that we've been experiencing. So again, no one else would believe that we're reducing the deficits with your budget. Thank you.
Recognize the gentlelady from West Virginia.
Thank you, Chairman Smith and Ranking Member Neal, and thank you, Secretary Yellen. I hope you take that cough drop. It's from me.
Thank you very much.
Your fiscal year 2022 revenue proposals, you recommended that Congress lower the 1099K threshold from the time-tested standard of $20,000 to just $600 with no transaction minimum in order to, and I quote, close the tax gap. Congressional Democrats heeded your request and included the provision without any debate or consideration. President Biden signed it into law, and he touts the accomplishments of that bill to this day. In December of last year, your IRS delayed the implementation of the provision that you recommended for a full year. The IRS cited the difficulty in administering the program as just one reason for this delay. Your IRS had a full year to prepare and to send taxpayers a bill that they likely didn't owe, and you could not handle the burden. If this policy was too difficult for the IRS to get right after a year of work with your 87,000 new agents, not all of which are even back in the office yet, how do you expect an individual, say he's selling his couch or drum set or old furniture, to handle the cost and the compliance burden?
Well, this was enacted into law in the American Rescue Plan, as you pointed out, and the IRS began to implement it as required and heard a number of concerns by individuals and organizations that this was confusing.
Oh, absolutely. I hate to interrupt you, but it is a nightmare for people that pass money back and forth. You know, one pays the rent, one does such and such, and they Venmo back and forth. I've spent the better part of 2 years trying to fix the mess that the Democrats created with this provision, and I want to thank every one of my Republican colleagues for co-sponsoring my bill, H.R. 190, and I certainly hope that my Democrat colleagues will do the same thing to protect all of our constituents from an undue burden on just a bad policy. Secretary Yellen, in May of 2021, just after the Biden administration pushed through the $1.9 trillion spending bill on a partisan vote, you claimed that 5% inflation at the time would be transitory, meaning temporary and brief. And I'm sure that the Biden administration based decisions on your analysis. But a year later, in June 2022, inflation then hit a 40-year high of 9.1%. A few weeks ago, this committee held its first hearing in my home state, and all of our witnesses said that their number one hardship is dealing now in 2023 is still inflation, the direct result of the failed economic policies of the Biden administration. Obviously, inflation is not transitory. You were wrong, and the people that are suffering as a result would really like to know if you might apologize for saying that and being wrong and misleading them.
Well, inflation is the president's top priority to bring it down, and it is certainly too high. It has come down off its highs a year ago. Over the last year, we've made progress. And in part, that reflects what I meant at the time was there were disturbances from the pandemic on supply chains that would eventually resolve. And due to the president's efforts and the passage of time, those supply chain disturbances have largely resolved.
Please.
Shipping costs have come down.
They have not.
Substantially, inventories that had been depleted have largely been rebuilt.
I really
but
think
there
that
remain
the
inflationary pressures
really should hear
that
is
need
that
to
I'm
be
sorry.
Dealt with. And Russia's war on Ukraine has also exacerbated
I yield back.
Inflation.
The gentlelady from Washington is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Madam Secretary. I'm way on the other side here. Thank you for your time today and for just all of your attention to the needs of working families and struggling Americans. And in particular, I want to thank you for recognizing the importance of affordable housing by introducing in the budget an increase in the low-income housing tax credit or the housing credit. And a reduction in bond financing necessary to trigger more housing credit equity. These core proposals are from legislation that I've introduced, the Affordable Housing Credit Improvement Act, which we will be reintroducing again this year with Representatives LaHood, Beyer, and Wenstrup. So a very strong bipartisan proposal. These provisions would finance the production and preservation of over 2 million additional affordable homes and support 3 million jobs over the next decade. I wondered if you could speak to how increasing the supply of affordable housing will increase our economy's long-term growth potential.
Well, I think we really have a serious shortage of affordable housing, and it really makes it very difficult to hire workers to be able to support business expansion when lower-income workers are unable to even afford to be able to live anywhere near where they work. And I think that's been a failing of our housing policy that we believe should be corrected.
Yeah, well, thank you so much for including that. I wanted to switch gears a little bit. Last year, this committee held a hearing to discuss ways to strengthen economic relations with Taiwan. One way to do so would be by negotiating an income tax agreement, which would boost investment and create jobs by reducing double taxation on U.S. and Taiwanese businesses. I wondered if you could update the committee on how Treasury is evaluating Taiwan's request for an income tax agreement with the United States.
We recognize that there's a problem there and are looking at potential ways to address it, but I don't have anything specific to offer in terms of way forward.
Well, we look forward to and hope you'll continue to consult with Congress on that, since that's clearly a very important issue. And then lastly, during yesterday's markup of the Republicans' debt prioritization bill, I asked the majority staff a technical question that they couldn't answer regarding the logistical possibility of debt prioritization. And so I just wanted to ask you, Madam Secretary, is it feasible for Treasury's payment systems to prioritize payments to bondholders over debt?
I think that we should not think that prioritization is a solution to the debt ceiling issue. Prioritization is simply not paying all of the government's bills when they come due. That is something we have never done since 1789, and that really is just default by another name. So what's critical is that we maintain our commitment to pay the government's bills, all the government's bills, when they come due. And if we don't do that and think that there's some shortcut around it that will avoid economic chaos, we're kidding ourselves, because not paying the government's bills will produce economic and financial collapse. And I would say that Fitch has already made clear in comments that they issued that a failure to pay all of the government bills would potentially prompt a downgrade of our debt.
Thank you, Madam Secretary. I appreciate that. I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Gentleman from Oklahoma is recognized.
Madam Secretary, over here. Madam Secretary, I really appreciate you being here today. Madam Secretary, with all due respect, and we've talked about this both times you've been here, your go-it-alone OECD negotiations have been a failure. Your Democrat majority House, Senate, President did not adopt these rules last year. Here we are, and there's no way in the world that Republicans are going to adopt this. I don't know how you think that circumventing Congress would be a way to do this. When I think you would acknowledge that both of our jobs is to protect the U.S. worker, the U.S. taxpayer, and the U.S. fisc, but you're making it much harder by not allowing us to be a part of this process as we're supposed to do here on Ways and Means. And there's no reason that we should expect that China is going to play nicely with these rules. I mean, they're kicking out Western auditors right now, and we're just thinking that we're going to know exactly what their state-owned, state-regulated enterprises are going to participate and be transparent. I mean, trust me, we would like to know their transparency, but we simply do not. How does this ability to, this is a rhetorical question, but I guess we're trying to figure out, because we don't know, how in your OECD negotiations you plan on holding them accountable? You know, Madam Secretary, the American people need to know this. I mean, we're transferring and redoing our entire international tax system, your words, not mine, to stop the race to the bottom. And we have asked repeatedly, myself, Kevin Brady, others, I'd like to once again submit another letter for the record requesting
without objection.
Thank you. Madam Secretary, what are you doing to prevent China from cheating? Madam Secretary, when are you going to release the analysis of the impact of Pillar 1 and Pillar 2 tax frameworks on the U.S. fisc? And do you have the revenue modeling data? Or are you just not sharing it? Or do you not have the data at all? And I'll give you the remaining 1 minute and 34 seconds to respond to all those questions.
We've presented in the budget estimates of the impact of Pillar 2, which we urge adoption of by Congress. Other countries are adopting Pillar 2. The European Union has already adopted it and put it into effect. And this is a huge positive for the United States. Of course, it's up to Congress to decide if we should come into compliance with Pillar 2 or not. But we're the only country in the world that imposes any tax at all on the foreign earnings of domestic corporations. No other country does that, And what the OECD agreement does is 137 countries agreed that they will start to do what we already do, and they will agree to impose a higher tax rate than we currently.
So, Madam Secretary, if you have all the, with all due respect, Madam,
how is that bad for the competitiveness?
Madam Secretary, I agree. You know that that sounds all great, but if we've asked time and time again for you to give us this information for the last 2 years when we were not even in the majority.
We have consulted regularly with this committee.
Excuse me?
We have consulted regularly with this committee.
You've not responded with the information we requested. And Madam Secretary, in the remaining 7 seconds, answer the question how we're going to hold China accountable. We can't even keep balloons from flying across the United States. How are we going to hold them accountable to the OECD framework?
If China is not accountable, we will tax the income of Chinese companies operating in the United States. And the same is true for all other countries that adopt Pillar 2 and its associated under tax payments rule. That's the strong enforcement mechanism that's built into this agreement, that a country that is non-compliant and decides they wish to be a tax haven, that other countries have the ability to punish that by taxing those firms themselves.
You're assuming fair playing field. I yield back.
Thank you. The gentleman from North Carolina is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Madam Secretary, for coming. Is the workforce participation rate a different statistic than the unemployment rate?
Of course.
Yes. So our unemployment rate may be the same as it was pre-pandemic, but our workforce participation rate is a full percentage lower, which means more than 2.5 million workers are not in the workforce. You've said you think a great number are retirees. I would submit that's not the case. We right now, because Biden's continuation of the public health emergency continues with 18 million people on Medicaid who do not qualify for benefits and therefore not going into the workforce. Second is that retirees that left, our stock market has crashed, inflation has gone through the roof, so I don't see those people staying at home. So it is disingenuous to say that we're in the same situation as we were pre-pandemic. We've been paying people and enticing them not to come back to work. Second point, the Inflation Reduction Act passed without a single Republican vote. It was done behind doors, a very partisan piece of legislation. Fortunately, Senators Thune and Sinema dropped an amendment which passed 57-43. The Thune amendment fixed a provision that said that small and medium-sized businesses, which are in my district, could be subject to the books. It fixed this. If not, they would have been subject to the book's minimum tax administrative and financial burdens. I think that the congressional intent was very clear. I think this administration has done everything it can to run around congressional intent. I ask unanimous consent to insert into the text the amendment, debate, and the final vote tally for the record, Mr. Chairman.
Without objection, so ordered.
Secretary Yellen, as you remember, there was a bipartisan amendment to clarify this in small business. Do you agree it was the intent of Congress in the Thune Amendment was to maintain the current law aggregation rules? Yes or no?
I want to make sure I understand. You're talking about the corporate alternative minimum tax?
Would stay in its current state.
So it only applies to corporations with financial statement or book income in excess of $1 billion.
All right, thank you. On another topic, I've heard from many small businesses in my district. I have a very research and development strong district and state in North Carolina. Very concerned about the lapsed R&D expensing loss. This is a major problem for new startups when they're trying to develop new cures and new drugs. This is supported in the House and the Senate by Democrats and Republicans. But as far as I can tell, the R&D expensing was omitted from the budget. Will you commit to helping us get Section 174, the R&D expensing, across the finish line so that these companies will not be hurt?
Well, we are in favor of support of R&D. Currently, the FDII, which is part of the taxation system for firms with derived intangible income.
So it's really hurt our young businesses that are trying to start out.
That and working with Congress to put something more effective.
I appreciate that because it hurts small businesses that are trying to put new molecules, new cures when they have no income coming in. Lastly, can you explain to me what the rationale is of taxing unrealized gains? We are taxing something that someone has not even realized yet, when in the future that number could actually be a loss. And so we're going to go after them for a potential. It's like putting somebody in jail for a potential murder that they might do. So what is the rationale?
We have a situation where hardworking teachers and firefighters are paying a higher share of their income in taxation than billionaires who derive most of their income from unrealized capital gains.
Well, they have to realize them to gain income.
Well, we're suggesting a tax on individuals earning more than $100 million that would essentially be a prepayment of taxes that are due upon death.
So we want to get the money in now so we can spend it now so there'll be even further deficit in the future.
I think it's entirely fair that extremely wealthy people should be taxed.
Thank you. I've used up my time, but I'm not talking about the wealth of the person. I'm talking about the actual theory of attacking somebody before they've actually gained their money. And again, it's like putting somebody in prison before they've done the murder. So
we want to thank you
for that, Mr. Chairman. I'll yield back.
Yep. The gentle lady from California is recognized.
Secretary Yellen, I thank you for being here. Last year, during our fiscal year 2023 hearing, I asked you what Treasury was doing to address the unacceptable fact that low-income EITC filers were getting audited 4.5 times more frequently than all other taxpayers earning under $500,000. You answered this. You said the resources available to the IRS have been simply gutted, and it does not have the capacity to enforce our tax laws as they apply to high-end evaders. It also meant that taxpayer experience was unacceptably poor, with long wait times for calls and a backlog of unprocessed returns. Well, we heard you, and thanks to the Inflation Reduction Act, we put in $80 billion to the IRS to improve these functions, and we can already see the positive effect. Contrary to the massive misinformation by those on the other side of the aisle, there has been a sea change. And in fact, the Washington Post just did an article earlier this week saying the IRS braces for the unthinkable, a normal tax season. And in fact, it said the IRS's massive funding boost has begun to reach the front lines of the tax season. It's vaulted the agency from more than a decade of disarray to a once unimaginable position, a functioning tax service. The IRS is answering 90% of its phone calls, has squashed its backlog of overdue returns, introduced new online taxpayer tools to keep pace with private software companies, and processed 99.7% of returns filed this tax season. And not only that, tax professionals are saying that now the agency will be able to keep up with phone calls and written correspondence, and most importantly, disperse for refunds in a timely manner. So, I just have to say, phone calls are getting answered with an average wait time of 7 minutes only. And also, of the $850 million spent by the IRS, more than half of the funds have gone directly to taxpayer services.
Yes.
I also want to address an issue from earlier, which is the IRS does have a law enforcement team that they use for extremely serious cases on noncompliance. Earlier, the gentleman from Georgia demanded there be no additional ammunition purchases. But actually, these law enforcement officials need ammunition to even qualify for their job. This demand from the gentleman from Georgia would actually put law enforcement officials in harm's way and is actually anti-police. So can you address both issues about the increased functioning of the IRS and this law enforcement issue?
Well, I agree with what you said on both scores, and I appreciate the description you gave of all of the ways in which taxpayer service has improved since the IRA provided this funding. It's a high priority, and there will be more to come. And there will also be a focus on hiring skilled tax attorneys and accountants who will be able to audit the returns of high-income and wealthy taxpayers, complex partnerships, corporations, where we know there's very substantial underreporting of income, and there will be an increased payoff to that over time, and that will be another important focus that you will see play out in terms of a reduction in the tax gap over time. With respect to the officers and the bullets, it's true there is a small cadre of essentially they're trained as law enforcement officers, individuals who do carry weapons to deal with very...
Gentlelady's time has expired.
Thank you.
Gentleman from Texas, Tennessee, is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Madam Secretary, for appearing today. I want to go back and talk about the Inflation Reduction Act and follow up on Congressman Adrian Smith's questions and maybe Congressman Drew Ferguson. When we've been asked you about the number of audits, specifically of those taxpayers making less than $400,000, your reply has been something to the effect that it won't increase compared to historical levels. My question to you is, isn't it right that the actual number of taxpayers making more or less than $400,000, those audits will increase? Isn't that right?
Well,
the actual number?
I don't have that information, but if the size of that population goes up and you maintain a constant audit rate, the number would probably rise.
Fair enough. And that's as a result of the passage of the Inflation Reduction Act, correct?
Well, I'm not sure what you mean by that.
I voted against the creation of the Inflation Reduction Act, which increases the number of audits. We've established those taxpayers more than $400,000. I asked you about the number, not at historical levels, the actual number of taxpayers making less than $400,000. You gave me your answer, and isn't that a direct result of the passage of the Inflation Reduction Act?
It depends on what the policy is. I've directed the IRS not to raise audit rates on individuals or small businesses earning under $400,000. And what's happened is the IRS has been starved for resources.
Let me ask you this. This is in relation to the letter that was sent by the Congressional Budget Office to then-ranking member Kevin Brady and then-ranking member of the Budget Committee Jason Smith, dated August 25th, 2022. How will taxpayers with incomes less than $400,000 be affected by the Act? And I realize you don't have the letter in front of you. The Act will affect taxpayers with incomes less than $400,000 in several ways. Activities other than audits, such as collections and automated screening and document matching, are not constrained by the Secretary's directive, and under the 2022 Reconciliation Act, the amounts they generate will be greater for taxpayers with all amounts of income, CBO projects. My question to you is, you don't have any reason to doubt what CBO cites in this letter, do you?
Look, we want taxpayers to be able to pay and to pay the amounts that are due. And improvements in technology may raise compliance in ways that are not directly related to the fraction of individuals that are audited. And, the failure
automatic screening and document matching for those taxpayers under $400,000 will be increased. You don't disagree with the CBO report, do you?
I haven't read it in detail, but...
Fair enough. I'll submit this for the record.
You know, we have a $7 trillion tax gap, and the IRS really needs to close that because it undermines the fairness and effectiveness of our tax system not to have a system that collects taxes that are owed and due.
The gentleman from Pennsylvania is recognized.
Thank you, Madam Secretary, for being here and for your time today. We appreciate it. I want to address a separation of powers issue and concerns with the IRA. The IRA's free trade agreement requirement, specifically for critical mineral inputs on batteries, was clear, and congressional intent upon the passage of the IRA with respect to that was clear. And yet, the administration is now seeking to redefine free trade agreements, which everyone knows to do that would require approval by the members of this body, now referring to it as a, quote, free trade area, in order to extend the law's benefits to Japan and the European Union, with which the United States does not have a congressionally approved free trade agreement. Madam Secretary, are you aware that during the pandemic semiconductor chip shortage, Japan and Germany withheld semiconductor chips from U.S. automakers here in our country in favor of their own automakers?
I wasn't aware of that, but I...
Are you also aware that the United States accepts Japanese vehicle certification on imports from Japanese autos into our country? However, Japan does not reciprocate.
I'm not aware of
Japan, in fact, Madam Secretary, Japan's rules intentionally do not conform to U.S. car regulations. U.S. car manufacturers must navigate a very complex environment when exporting to Japan. These are non-tariff barriers that disadvantage autos made here in the United States. Next question, are you aware that just this week, the U.S. ambassador to the World Trade Organization stated that Japan must take bold steps to lower trade barriers related to autos and agricultural products?
So, look, with respect to the IRA in Japan, Japan does process and extract critical minerals that are used by American car makers. And the thought is that in order to improve the security of our supply chains, the United States might negotiate agreements pertaining to critical minerals, not to say that the conditions are there now, but that there would be negotiations of agreements with countries like Japan or with European countries. There would have to be requirements. They wouldn't, presumably your requirement is that you couldn't put export controls in place.
I understand that, but with
regard- crunch would prevent enable a country to withhold exports. So this would be a matter of arriving at agreements. They might have labor or environmental standards.
Surely you understand that that requires congressional approval, correct? This misinterpretation is essentially a balance of power, a separation of power issues.
I think we need to be in close communication with this
committee. Understood, but I just want to point out the disparity. Are you aware that U.S. autos exported to the EU incur a 10% tariff? However, the United States only imposes a 2.5% tariff on European auto imports.
This may all be true, but what we're talking about are critical minerals and attempting to meet the objective of Congress in passing this legislation.
My time is about to expire. Last question.
To improve supply chains.
Last question. Are you also aware, this is to my point, that China is the biggest supplier of battery technology and production to both Japan and EU, the countries I'm referencing?
We're trying to reduce our dependence on China with this legislation.
My time has expired. I yield back.
The gentlelady from Wisconsin is recognized.
Thank you so very, very much, and thank you for appearing, Secretary Yellen. I have so enjoyed our relationship back from when you were chair of the Fed, and really, you are so qualified to appear before this committee and answer some of our important questions. I have a couple of questions, and if I have repeated things that others have already made inquiry about, please forgive me. I was called away for other business. Not more important than you, but just other business. Recognizing tribal sovereignty, I was really pleased to see that the Biden administration included a recommendation to include tax parity for Indian Health Services scholarships. And I'm working with Mr. Schweikert here on the committee and Mr. Kildee here and Congressman Kelly, looking forward to going forward on tax parity for tribal nations, unconstrained by artificial and arbitrary essential government function test. so that we can increase the effectiveness of the low-income housing tax credit and the new markets tax credits on tribal communities. So I am so happy that you are moving forward that, and how do you think that will that it inform, will improve our GDP?
I think it's an important initiative. The low-income housing tax credit is critical, and I think improving situation with respect to housing in tribal lands addresses a critical need.
It really does, because the infrastructure needs on Indian land are tremendous, and so this would create a lot of economic activity. I wanted to ask you, and you're Secretary of Treasury now, but again, you are very brilliant and you've been chair of the Fed. You say that the Biden budget will cut the deficit by nearly $3 trillion over 10 years. And I am delighted to see that you are not proposing doing that with austerity tactics, like just eliminating, you know, of course, we're getting out of the emergency stuff, but the EITC is expanded, the child tax credit is here. SNAP, you haven't talked about reducing. You certainly are protecting the ACA, recommending child care. Yes, you want people to get back to work, but the dignity of work doesn't necessarily mean working at 7:25 an hour. How are you able to reduce the deficit by $3 trillion without austerity?
So the president's focus is on hardworking families who are struggling to make ends meet and providing them with the tools they need to make life a little bit easier, whether it's improvements in the cost of health care, lowering prescription drugs, educating their children by adding a year of preschool, a child tax credit, making child care affordable. These are ways of giving working families some breathing room, and the budget focuses on that, and it doesn't raise taxes by a penny on any household or small business earning less than $400,000. And it pays for those initiatives by remedying what I think is an unfairness about our tax system, that it lets wealthy individuals, very high-income individuals, and corporations off with lighter tax loads than a school teacher or a firefighter or a policeman have to pay. And so it raises additional revenue in a variety of different ways by asking those high-income, wealthy individuals and corporations to pay their fair share.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chairman, and I would yield back.
Recognize the gentlelady from New York.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and before I get started, I just wanted to say thank you to Ms. Sewell, Mr. Davis, and Mr. Kelly. I look forward to working with you on this crucial legislation relating to the new markets tax credit and making it permanent. The credit has delivered for districts in my own upstate New York district, and I'm committed to pushing this priority across the finish line. Secretary Yellen, I just want to say thank you for appearing here today, and thank you for your service. There are so many important topics that we need to be addressed, and Americans are suffering from the biggest price increases in over 40 years. Small businesses like mine and all of upstate New York are feeling the pain of labor shortages and Democratic tax hikes. Taxpayers' personal information is being exposed in massive leaks, and your Treasury Department is actively working to bypass Congress and cede U.S. tax authority to foreign countries. U.S. companies and workers need an international tax landscape that offers certainty, promotes investment and innovation, and incentivizes critical research and development here in America. Instead, it seems like Treasury has unwittingly bitten off more than it can chew by negotiating a deal with the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, the OECD, that gives away our tax revenues, reduces the competitiveness of U.S. companies and workers, and erodes overall economic strength. And I know many of my colleagues have talked about this. If this deal were finalized, it would result in fewer jobs and less prosperity for millions of Americans and their families. Secretary Yellen, Treasury has the responsibility of negotiating
at the OECD. But why do you believe that Treasury has the authority to do so without proper consultation with Congress? And I might add, you've testified today that you have reported to Congress, but you have not consulted or collaborated with Congress in a way before cutting these deals with Europe. And don't you agree that you are appointed to this position, not anointed to this position?
I certainly am appointed, not anointed. Absolutely agree. And we have consulted and not only informed.
Can you explain where you could ongoing? Can you explain where the consultation and collaboration has been done so in a public forum with both sides, where we have seen this, and that has we have not seen that. We've seen reporting. Reporting is not consultation.
Our staff have regular briefings with staff of this committee, and I have had many conversations with the chair and ranking member of this committee on ongoing developments whenever there's something new that occurs in the negotiations. And I don't know if you're talking about Pillar 1 or Pillar 2 of the tax agreement. Pillar 2 is certainly something that cedes no taxing rights, is an international agreement by which other countries have
reclaim my time. You have allowed other countries to tax our own countries, and not you stood up again the United under the GILTI tax and also the book minimum tax. You have we got these, and then you didn't fight for a fair treatment of these and these negotiations. So why didn't you protect these taxes, and why are other foreign entities and countries in the agreement allowed to now tax our U.S.-based countries?
Well, look, we have every right to tax our companies as we see fit. Congress is not obliged to do anything, but the Pillar 2 does allow punishment by countries that participate in the agreement in a sense of countries that wish to be tax havens by they may undertake, and this is one of their taxing rights, to impose additional
So let me reclaim my time. You're admitting that.
General ladies, time has expired.
That we have given our priorities up to foreign countries.
General ladies, time has expired.
We haven't given anything up.
The gentleman from Minnesota is recognized.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair, and thank you, Secretary, for being here today. And I want to talk a little bit. I know we talk a lot about big things in D.C., but we don't always talk about what's happening in real America. And most of the work in my district is done by small businesses, family farms, small manufacturers, and they and I are very concerned that the taxes in the president's budget will hurt them. It will affect them. No matter what we say, it's going to affect them. And they're already faced with increased costs, fuel. For farmers, input costs due to inflation in the economy right now. And the president's budget includes more than $300 billion in new taxes on non-corporate taxpayers. Secretary, why does the president believe that now, as we are just emerging from the economic destruction of COVID, we should increase taxes on small family-owned businesses?
The president's budget doesn't contain a penny of new taxes on any individual earning under $400,000 or small business earning under $400,000. So the taxes that are raised are all on high income, especially very high income individuals, and on corporations that are not small businesses and that benefit from many tax preferences and lower tax rates. In some cases, income isn't taxed at all, and it results in a situation where many of your constituents who are concerned about rising costs and health care costs and the cost of education and are burdened by such costs, it results in a situation where they're paying higher tax rates, a higher fraction of their income than a billionaire who earns most of their income.
I reclaim my time. And Secretary, with all due respect, I mean, we are facing limits, and so I just wanted to, because I think we disagree on that. And I think that we're reading things differently and understanding what's in the proposal. And I think that's why the chair earlier asked for the legislative copy, the legislative language of it, because and I'm reading the Green Book.
The Green Book contains
I'm looking
as
at
much
it.
Description.
Ma'am, I'm looking at it, Secretary. I'm looking at it right now, but I think that's so that we are looking at the same thing, because we have a much different understanding of how the taxes are going to affect those people in my district. And just, you know, so I will say with the tax increases that are included and the death tax included in the president's budgets, you know, I got to wonder, how does the president expect family farms to survive with all of the things that we're burdening them with? And I have real concern about that. And I know that last year we fought very hard regarding the stepped up basis, and I believe it's back in here. Like I said, I'm continuing to read because we got the green sheet or whatever you call it yesterday. So we're continuing to read. But if we have your assurance that these people are not going to pay any more taxes, are not going to see those death taxes, but I have real concerns. And with that, I yield back. My time is up.
Gentlelady from Alabama is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Madam Secretary, thank you for being here today to provide further insight into this administration's budget request. It is my belief that our federal budget must present opportunities for all Americans to achieve economic prosperity. This is done so with the commitment of significant investments in communities, especially those communities that have lived on the margins due to economic circumstances. I can think of no better tool to achieve the kind of leveling the playing field in marginalized, vulnerable communities than the Newmarket tax credit. I want to join Representative Tenney in applauding President Biden's proposed budget for including a permanent extension of Newmarket tax credits. This crucial tax credit has been instrumental in promoting economic growth and development in underserved communities, creating jobs, expanding businesses, and including access to health care, job training, child care, and other important social services. The Newmarket tax credit is a valuable tool that has enabled investors to inject much-needed capital into distressed communities. Since its inception, this program has delivered over $120 billion, with a B, in total project investments, providing a lifeline to businesses and communities that have been long overlooked. In my hometown of Selma, Alabama, the Newmarket tax credit is supporting the expansion of a business called GMI, which produces silicone-based alloys and other strategic materials which feed our nation's supply chain for semiconductors, solar energy products, military energy storage, and the like. The expanded facility in my hometown generated 100 skilled jobs. It is this level of success that I would like to see replicated in districts all around the country. I know that this is currently in the proposed budget, but I want to assure you that it has bipartisan support. In the 117th Congress, I introduced the bipartisan legislation to make the Newmarket tax credits permanent, H.R. 1321, and we had 126 co-sponsors. I look forward to working with my colleagues like Congresswoman Tenney and also reintroducing a similar piece of legislation. Last Congress, I also introduced the Rural Jobs Act with Chairman Jason Smith to expand the program and to provide $1 billion in Newmarket tax credit allocation targeted to persistent underserved rural communities. My question is, can you elaborate on how this tool can be used, why it's so important that we make it permanent, and how you see this affecting underserved communities all across this country?
Well, I agree with you. I think it's a very important tool to promote investment in communities that have historically been left behind and can be a real spur to economic development, and that's why the budget does propose to make it permanent. And I would say more broadly, a priority of the Biden administration has been a focus on place-based policies so that communities that historically have suffered, we've had areas of the country that have grown very rapidly, seen
Absolutely.
Big increases in income, and others that yep. have lagged. And many of the acts that have already been passed, the IRA, the Infrastructure Act, the Semiconductors Act, and the ARP that increased funding of community CDFIs.
To respect
and minority
the let's time expired, Secretary, to respect your time and to make sure we get every one of these. When that clock hits through, let's just stop talking.
Okay.
Gentleman from Utah is recognized.
Secretary Yellen, thank you for being here. This is a substantive work. It's important for our nation. I appreciate you willing to come so quickly after the budget was released, and I hope you felt that we do respect your expertise. I'm going to talk about something very personal, something that I think that this entire committee is supportive of, and that is those individuals that are in the adoption space and the adoption tax credit. According to a GAO report from 2011 and a taxpayer advocate report from 2012, families claiming the adoption tax credit in those years faced an audit rate nearing 70%, a 69% of audit rate. The national average is 0.8. So, I mean, the discrepancy here is enormous, and it's concerning. So this is a specific example of what we want to talk about, because a lot gets said here in the concept of audits. But these are staggering numbers. I haven't been able to find any data more recent than 2012. What has been the audit rates for families claiming the adoption tax credit over the past 5 years?
So I don't have that information at my fingertips, but I would be glad to get back to you. And I think the issue that you're raising is certainly a legitimate one that I would try to work with you on and better understand.
These are families that are watching what's going on. They're concerned that this is only going to ramp up as opposed to go away, and that's a staggering issue. The fact that you have it here is okay. Is it something that's been being collected over the past several years, to your knowledge?
I honestly need to look into that. I just am not certain. I assume that data is available, but I joined this committee, and we'll get back to you.
Thank you, Secretary. I joined this committee with real legislation that should be hugely bipartisan to help address this and other issues with our folks that are out there adopting foster care and from infancy. And I mentioned that this is very important for us. One piece of your testimony, and I'm going to keep the time here. One piece of your testimony, it talked about the race to the bottom with respect to corporate tax rates. I can give specific examples from Procter & Gamble, from Nucor. These are rural-based companies in my district, and I've met and sat down with each of them. When they talk to me about when their taxes become globally competitive, so from the Tax Cut and Jobs Act, the two things that they highlight the most is, one, their ability to pay middle-class and frontline workers more salary, and they've got the data that shows that they raise those wages. And the second thing is what they've been able to do to give back to their communities. Ambulances for Box Elder County, a specific example that sticks out to me. I'm concerned at the communication going ahead and not looking at what actually happened with some of these tax rates when we became globally competitive, and just going ahead and raising them just to cover more spending that we're seeing from the president's budget. What am I to tell these companies right now, as there's a potential from 21 to 28% increase, which is an enormous and it will be a very impactful increase? What am I to tell these individuals?
Well, I think that the tax cut on the corporate level that was introduced by the Tax Cut and Job Act, I think it was appropriate to cut corporate tax rates. It wasn't. We had one of the highest rates globally, and it needed to come down, and it wasn't very effective in raising corporate tax revenue, but it came down too much. And I don't think we have seen the economic payoff from that in the form of great increases in investment spending.
Thank you. Thank you so much for that.
The gentlelady from California is recognized.
Thank you, Chairman Smith, for holding this important hearing, and thank you for your service, Secretary Yellen. Progressive spending has led to record inflation, and now this administration wants to add fuel to the fire. I was alarmed yesterday when I discovered the President Biden's request includes a 15% increase to the IRS annual funding. That's a $2.1 billion increase over the enacted funding levels for 2023 on the top the extra $80 billion Progressive gave to the IRS last year. The IRS exists to serve Americans, not to make the lives of taxpayers harder. It has been reported that millions of tax returns from previous years are still not processed. In my district, that we've been getting a lot of inquiries about how to get the refunds from the IRS. If the IRS owns my constituents' money, it could take years from them to receive their return. Many have expressed concerns about IRS snooping on their private bank record and transactions, heightened with sensitive personal information being released in years past. You claim that you are not going after lower and middle class Americans, yet progressives have been working behind the census, lower the 1099K threshold. Why should every American who are dealing with record inflation pay their rent and repay for their ticket event tickets now go out of their way to file unneeded burdensome tax forms with lack of proper security? And why are you in favor of adding more unnecessary filing when the IRS is already dealing with endless backlogs?
Well, the objective of this legislation with respect to 1099-Ks was to make sure that Americans have the information they need to accurately file their returns and pay the taxes that are due, because there are Americans who receive money from business that they do may be relatively small, and most Americans receive reports they use to file their income taxes on their wages and salaries, their interest and dividend income, and this is other income on which taxes are due.
I totally get that, but we already have that in the law right now, that 1099-K, when you receive more than $600 transaction, then you have to file it. That's adding another burdensome to the taxpayers.
It was lowered in the ARP from, I believe, $20,000 to $600, because many Americans who earned less than $20,000 probably weren't getting that information and paying the taxes that were due. And it's, you know, this was in the law. The IRS needed to implement what's in the law. And it's up to Congress to decide what the right.
I yield back. Thank you.
Gentleman from Michigan is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Madam Secretary. Thank you. It's good to see you. First, let me just comment. I listened to Mr. Fitzpatrick's questions and comments regarding trade authority, and I just want to state the record that we don't agree on everything across the aisle, but I think there is general concern about the direction of trade negotiation and where that authority lies, and I look forward to further conversation with the administration to provide greater clarity and to protect the prerogatives of Congress in that respect. We learned a lot, Madam Secretary, during the pandemic about supply chains, what can go wrong when we rely too heavily on other countries, particularly China, for example, for critical goods and components that are essential to our economy. And I was really proud to work with the administration on the CHIPS and Science Act, the Inflation Reduction Act, both of which will support American workers, bringing manufacturing jobs back to our country. In my district, I happen to have a company, Hemlock Semiconductor, that makes polysilicon, a base material for both semiconductors and for solar panels. included in the CHIPS and Science Act is a tax credit to onshore production of these really important materials. As Treasury drafts its guidance for this credit, does Treasury plan to include the entire supply chain of semiconductors, including polysilicon?
So I think we're in the process of drafting those regulations. I don't have the answer to your question, but we would value your input on this, certainly take it into account and get back to you on this matter.
I appreciate that. I'm certainly not in a position as a single member of Congress to express congressional intent, but I know as I was working on this legislation, this is certainly the sort of application that we had in mind for the credit, and so I'd ask you to take a very close look at
certainly
that.
Certainly, we will do that.
The Inflation Reduction Act also supports domestic manufacturing of solar panels.
Yes.
Right here in the U.S. instead of relying on those produced in China. I worked on legislation to do this because it makes sense for us to trade foreign dependence on oil to foreign independence on solar panels. We don't want to do that.
Of course.
Our legislation includes a domestic content bonus to spur domestic manufacturing, not just domestic jobs for installing solar panels. So a strong domestic content standard will enable larger investment in U.S. solar manufacturing. Does Treasury plan to issue any guidance that incentivizes domestic manufacturing for across the solar panel value chain? Similar question to my first question.
So I believe we're in the process of, we have rules that we have to write in connection with claiming those credits, and there are an enormous number of rules that we need to write. We have prioritized some of the most urgent ones, but we will be producing a rule on that.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that, and thank you for being here. I yield back the balance of my time.
Recognize the lady from Texas. Gentle lady from Texas.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. You know, for a party that can't even define what a woman is, I find it rich that some of my Democrat colleagues want to highlight International Women's Day and go after as if we are supposed to go soft on the secretary today. I'm going to demand that everybody treat us as equals and don't demean us just because we were born with ovaries. I don't care if it is International Women's Month. It's disturbing that this administration continues to peddle the big lie that people making less than $400,000 are not paying more in taxes. You said it yourself this morning that people making less than $400,000 won't pay a penny more in new taxes, not a penny more. And maybe you need to get out of D.C. more, because a lot of us are paying more in new taxes. Let's just review a few. Income taxes. Wages have artificially increased, but because of inflation, the dollar value has actually decreased. So many people that are making less than $400,000 that saw wage increases are now paying more in income taxes, correct?
Well, we don't have perfect indexation.
Fuel taxes. Gas prices have increased from a national average of $2.35 when Biden took office to now $3.41 a gallon this week. So are people making $400,000 paying more in fuel taxes?
More in fuel taxes?
Correct. Yes. So sales taxes. Groceries have increased by 12%. Eggs have increased by nearly 60%. Flour is up over 21%. Used cars are up over 9%. Are people making less than $400,000 paying more in sales taxes for simple things like food? Okay, ad valorem taxes. Housing prices have more than doubled in many markets around the country. A lot of times, that's dependent on how much people are paying in ad valorem taxes. So would you agree that people making more than $400,000 and own a house are paying more in ad valorem taxes?
Well, these are often state or local taxes.
Oh, sure. But we're talking about taxes, and here's the problem. When you're stuck in D.C., we don't see beyond D.C. But people are being taxed to death and are absolutely sick of it. And when you said people who make more than $400,000 are not being taxed a penny more, I guarantee you they would disagree with that.
What I said was that the president's budget.
People are paying more than they have in taxes, even if they're making less than $400,000. And it is a direct result of policies that have come out of this administration. And it's alarming that y'all don't seem to understand that overregulating, overspending, and increasing debt contributes to increased inflation. All of us are suffering from increased inflation, 14.4%. And yet, this administration keeps throwing its hands up and saying, it's not our fault, we didn't do anything. You've had party rule for the last 2 years. Take some responsibility.
The president is
last June, you told this committee that spending had come down and that there was no doubt that inflation was too high. And yet the Inflation Reduction Act that you just lauded used budget gimmicks and in fact added $745 billion in new spending. And now the president has come out with a massive budget, $7 trillion almost to spend, and then $4.7 trillion of new tax hikes. That meets the very definition of tax and spend. And is that not a return to increase in spending?
The president's budget and the laws that have been passed reduce many burdens on American households. It makes health care through the ACA far more affordable
than it was. I yield back my time. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
The gentlelady has yielded back her time. The gentleman from Iowa is recognized.
Thank you, Secretary Yellen, for being here today. Greatly appreciate it. Both Congress and the U.S. companies have been sounding alarms about Pillar 2 since the model rules were released in December of 2021. You know, the concerns, obviously, of how it was negotiated and also what was exactly agreed to. But I want to focus on probably the most common issue that I'm hearing about from our companies. Under the agreement, non-refundable tax credits can bring a company's U.S. Pillar 2 effective tax rates below 15% minimum. As you know, our tax laws are full of non-refundable business tax credits enacted by this committee over the decades, most notably the R&D credit. Other countries like the United Kingdom were able to protect this credit in their negotiations. I'm trying to understand why the Treasury Department would agree to curb and eliminate this incentive created by Congress to encourage investment, because we saw it beneficial to this economy. So the question is this. Secretary Yellen, why did the U.S. Treasury not try to negotiate rules that protected the U.S. R&D incentives in the same way the U.K. did, in the same way other European countries did, and we lost ours?
Well, I think that some of these incentives would have been lost under the BEAT, and our proposal would repeal the BEAT in favor of the undertaxed payments rule consistent with the model agreement, and in that sense is more favorable for R&D than what would otherwise have been the case.
So, in all fairness, so you're saying you're fine with it, that you're not going to go to bat for this R&D tax credit. You're not going to ask the other countries to accept it.
Well, we've said that we would look forward to working with Congress on an R&D credit that would be effective.
You know, and I know, that's a refundable tax credit. That's never going to happen because that's worth the, billions, trillions of dollars. That's just not going to happen. I mean, this is a big deal. I mean, this is a really big deal to every company when they can't take this R&D credit to lower that 15% minimum. I mean, yet the UK did and other countries did. I mean, we're at a tremendous advantage. Now, I hear what you're saying. And it's sort of capitulation. But, do you understand what these companies are asking here?
Well, most companies are able to make use of it because they don't come under these rules.
That's not the case. Mrs. Secretary Yellen, thank you for those comments. Mr. Chair, I'd like to submit a letter for the record stating that R&D is the manufacturing industry's number one priority, and this committee has already received that letter. Thank you, and I yield back.
Without objection, so ordered. Gentleman from Pennsylvania is recognized. Would you turn on the mic?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Madam Secretary, I'd like to agree that the President's budget reflects the progress that we have made. And I want to make sure he knows I thank him for his leadership and what you're doing. So I sincerely thank you very much. I don't want to speak about an issue I have spoken to you in the past about, an issue that really concerns around school buildings and facilities. I'm raising the issue about the rehabilitation historical tax credit, and that's an issue I've been working on for a long period of time. We have two high schools in my congressional district that discovered life-threatening asbestos, and basically what I've been attempting to do is to see if we can put together, the school buildings are at age 70, and I've basically been attempting to find ways to deal with school. So what I want to do is get your thoughts on allowing our nation's public schools access the historical tax credit and to use that tool. It's an issue I've consistently been raising. I'd like to get your thoughts on it.
Well, I think you're raising a very important issue in terms of dealing with school buildings, and it's something the administration thinks is important as well, and we can discuss what might be appropriate to deal with that issue and work with you on that.
Good. I want to thank you, Madam Secretary, for coming forward to the committee. Thank you for your honestness. Thank you again. I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
The gentlelady from New York is recognized.
Madam Secretary, you know my district very well because you were born in Bay Ridge, Brooklyn. Your alma mater is Fort Hamilton High School. So you also know that my district is one that is home to hardworking Americans who are trying to make ends meet during record high inflation. As this administration continues to recklessly print and spend money, is pushing American people to the limits. This administration is literally giving money with one hand and then they're taking it with the other when people are paying higher costs, whether it be the supermarket, the gas pump, the utility bills, et cetera. Seniors in my district, you know Bay Ridge is home to many seniors, are struggling to stay in their homes, and it is nearly impossible for young families to buy their first home. And CNBC reports credit card debt is at an all-time high, putting households near a breaking point. And all this while the Fed continues to raise interest rates and Democrats continue their spending spree. The public deserves to know, as do the members of this committee, how long you are aware that the massive spending packages were pushing us closer to the debt limit and why you stayed silent for so long. As you know, on December 23rd, 2022, Congress, under the Democrat control, passed $1.7 trillion omnibus spending package, which came after 2 years of aggressive unchecked spending and record deficits. However, you waited nearly a month until January 13th to send a letter to Speaker McCarthy in saying that we will be reaching the statutory limit and that you'd have to take extraordinary measures. Yes or no? Did you warn the president at the time that he was jamming through this package that you were going to be reaching that limit?
Well, look, we have run deficits for most of our history, and it's clear that we continually need to issue more debt in order to finance them.
But did you warn the president that we were going to be hitting the debt limit, or did you wait? Did you purposely wait, or did you tell the president?
The president knows very well that we would reach the debt limit, and members of Congress know that as well. And we sent you, we sent Congress, as we always do, a notification when it became clear that we would reach the debt limit.
Were you told by anyone in the White House not to say anything during that time of negotiation?
Of course not, and it's very clear what the outstanding debt is. It's entirely public information.
Yeah, it is true, but I find it odd that that three-week period between when that package passed or when it was even negotiated, that you didn't say anything as the Treasury Secretary to sound the alarm that we were heading down this, that we're going to hit, you're going to have to take extraordinary measures. It seems like something that the American people would want to know while they were jamming through this excessive package. But I'll move on to say that the Federal Reserve continues to raise interest rates to slow the amount of money circulating through the economy to drive down demand for goods and services with the goal of lowering prices and reducing inflation. But this, as you know, will not work. It does not work when government spending and the printing of new money continues at unsustainable levels, reducing the value of the dollar. Isn't it kind of like trying to pour water on a fire while also pouring gasoline? I mean, you admitted you were wrong when you said inflation was transitory. Will you be honest with the American people today and just tell them the truth that the inflation will not return back to the 1.4% of 2021 as long as government continues to print and spend?
No, I certainly wouldn't agree with that. And this year, the federal budget has, the deficit has declined substantially, and there's been a reduction in fiscal impetus toward inflation.
I understand. We're still at 6.4%, and we were at 1.4% at the beginning of this administration. I believe as long as we keep printing this money, we will never get back down to that inflation. So I hope you will pass that on to the administration.
Gentleman from Ohio is recognized.
Madam Secretary, thank you for being with us today and appreciate your service to the country.
Thank you.
I'm going to go through a statement. I'm going to try to keep my time brief. I'm a firm believer that those who don't know history are doomed to repeat it. And so I'm just going to go back as we have time to go through the Green Book and obviously look at all the dive into the budget. But on March of 2021, you said there was only a small risk that inflation would be a problem. And on May 2nd of 2021, you said you don't believe that inflation will be an issue. On May 27th, you stated that the recent inflation we were seeing at the time would be temporary. You also said that you believed interest rates would stay low. Then on October 29th of 2021, you said that monthly inflation rates would return to levels close to 2% towards the second half of the year. When referring to the Biden administration's infrastructure spending proposals, you actually said, "I don't think these investments will drive up inflation at all." You even went as far as to say that these spending packages were actually anti-inflationary. Finally, on June 1st of 2022, you conceded that you were wrong about the path that inflation would take. And as we all know, we were also wrong regarding your projections of the interest rates. And as the Fed right now is signaling that more rate hikes will probably happen until inflation gets under control, makes me wonder when we're going to get off the spending merry-go-round. But with that, I really would like to focus on just a couple things, because energy is something that's very important. But perhaps the biggest failure I've seen in U.S. sanctions over the last 2 years has been the inability to stop Iranian oil exports to China. And I appreciate the administration's recent sanctionings of the companies involved in the Iranian illicit oil trade. However, I'm concerned that these efforts are insufficient. So, real quick question, then I'm going to yield back. Would you agree our sanctions have been ineffective in stopping Iranian oil from being exported to China?
My sense is that there is, I need to look into that more fully, but probably our sanctions have not been fully effective. We are constantly looking to enforce them better and to step them up in order to meet this objective. So.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam Secretary. Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
The gentleman from Illinois is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Madam Secretary, thank you. Thank you for giving us a little bit of extra time so we all have a chance to ask a question. Yeah. It's greatly appreciated. And I want to commend the administration's work bringing the world together to try to address tax policy. The multilateral Pillar 1, Pillar 2 processes aim to provide certainty and predictability for U.S. companies operating abroad. That said, I do believe we have to ensure that the U.S. remains committed to following through on these efforts, working with Congress, and protecting the competitiveness of U.S. firms to ensure that we not only are growing American companies, but we are starting new companies and inspiring other countries to come here. So I thank you on that. I want to ask a quick question on the debt ceiling. I'll go home this weekend, and I will hear from all of my constituents what's going to happen, what's going to happen. Can you just remind us, I know we've talked about it, what do I say to Illinois taxpayers when they ask, what's going to happen if we don't address the debt ceiling?
I think we are going to be faced with economic and financial catastrophe. The United States government has always paid its bills since 1789, and not just some bills, but all bills that come due. U.S. treasuries are the safest asset in the entire financial system, and the U.S. dollar serves as the reserve currency. If there is a thought that Congress would allow the United States to default on its payments that it has to make, that will call into question the safety of these assets and potentially lead to a financial crisis. And if we got to the day when we're not able to make our payments and somehow we have to no longer make good on our obligations to Social Security recipients and veterans and the military and to all the providers.
And I apologize with limited time.
And yeah. Interest rates will spike. We saw that in 2011.
It'll be painful.
And
let me just ask the follow-up question.
We were downgraded, and that was a hit to the interest rates that all Americans
right, as someone once said, if we don't learn from history, we're going to repeat it. We saw it in 2013. We talked yesterday, we had a markup on this idea of prioritization, paying some of our bills, not all of our bills. Does paying some of our bills, A, is it feasible, and even if it was, would that still result in default?
It's still a default because I think most Americans would think, and most people in financial markets would feel that a country has obligations and they're looking to see the country meet the obligations it has. Not some of the obligations, but all of the obligations.
Great. And my last comment is thank you. In the Inflation Reduction Act, my legislation on sustainable aviation fuel was a part of what is the greatest investment we've ever made in addressing climate change. I look forward to working with you and your department, making sure that we get that in place so that America can lead the way in sustainable
aviation
fuel. Thank you.
We're working hard on
that. I yield
that.
Back.
Thank you.
The gentleman from California is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Madam Secretary. It seems that right now you have policymakers trying to bring about a managed slowdown of our economy, and you have investors trying to figure out if the economy is going to have a hard landing or a soft landing. But also, it seems because the economy is so stubbornly successful right now, we're trying to figure out if the economy is going to land at all. And so that's because the American economy right now is strong for a number of factors, and consumers and firms especially in major economies, they're in good financial health.
Yes.
But the acceleration of our economy means that the recession may not be imminent, is what we're seeing right now. So despite some of the complaints that we're hearing, it seems that we do still have to figure out a way to slow down the economy by bringing down inflation so that we can bring down inflation. And we have to figure out, you know, does that mean, do we raise interest rates to get inflation to that 2% target? Now, as you know, when you talk about rate adjustments and when they're made, there are long and variable lags for which and how they work. But experts are thinking that the previous interest rates that were just made, they might have been already played out. So looking forward, where do we go? Do we accept this continued inflation, or do we have to continue to raise interest rates for a second year in a row? And if we raise those rates, what is appropriate, Madam Secretary?
So, you know, this is a matter we leave up to the best judgment of the independent Federal Reserve. Having worn that hat in a prior life, I know that the kinds of judgments you're asking me to make are very difficult ones and require tremendously careful analysis of the economy, what's playing out, and how monetary policy operates. I know that my colleagues at the Fed are engaged in these discussions every day and want to do the best they can. They're clearly committed to bringing inflation back to their 2% target.
Okay, thank
they
you.
They also have a
thank
commitment
you.
To.
Thank you. I got a minute left, and it's your last minute. I'm going to make it real quick. What should our long-term goals be, Madam Secretary, when it comes to our debt?
That we have a sustainable fiscal trajectory. And to me, the single best metric is real net interest burden of the debt. And that's something we've focused on carefully in this budget. Historically, it's been at or a little bit above 1%. And if you look at the budget, with the deficit reduction it contains, the real net interest burden as a share of GDP right around 1%. So to me, that is a sustainable budget path, and it's one I use to evaluate fiscal sustainability.
Thank you, Madam Secretary. Mr. Chairman, I yield back. Thank you.
Thank you. Madam Secretary, thank you for your testimony. Sorry we went 12 minutes over, but we appreciate that you stayed for all of it. Please be advised that members have 2 weeks to submit written questions to be answered later in writing. Those questions and your answers will be made part of the formal hearing record. With that, the committee stands adjourned.